Good morning. I'm Rosalio Muñoz, undergraduate student body president, and I'd like to welcome you all. Muchas gracias. I'd like to welcome you all on behalf of ASUCLA to the second annual symposium on Chicano liberation, sponsored by the ASUCLA Speakers Program, the Student Legislative Council, and the Chancellor's Special Speakers Program, organized by UMAS UCLA. To begin the program, I would like to first of all introduce Dr. Simon Gonzalez, Assistant Dean of Education here at UCLA, who will introduce the program. Thank you very much. Simon.
Thank you, Ross. On behalf of the university, I want to welcome you and our guests to this symposium. I, like most of you in the audience, am extremely disappointed that our Gabacho students on this campus have shown so little interest in becoming better informed about the problems with which we are coping, about the dilemmas in which the Mexican-American finds himself in the Southwest, and about the plans that are being made for the future. All of you know, if you look around, all of you know that we are the second largest minority in the United States. All of you know that fully one-third of the 6 million Mexican-Americans are in the poverty category. All of you know that we have 800,000 Mexican-Americans living here in Los Angeles, that out of 28,000 teachers in our public schools, only 644 have Spanish surnames, and that many of these come from Cuba, Ecuador, and Argentina. The great majority of you know that we are desperately in need of role models, identification figures, that we have been delegated to the menial jobs, that opportunities have not been available to us. All of you also know that due to a very great extent by the efforts of the leaders, the men who will come before us today, that this picture is rapidly changing. Some of you may not know that the university has doubled its faculty of Chicanos this year. And now both of us are heavily involved trying to bring more Chicano students and more Chicano faculty to this campus. But seriously though, the chancellor and the faculty are interested in providing full support to us, and we are bringing about changes due to a very great extent, I will must emphasize, by the efforts of UMAS and the community support that we have had. It is a pleasure to introduce to you Mr. Juan Gomez, presently on the faculty at San Diego State College. Mr. Gomez is completing his doctorate in history here at UCLA. He is director of Chicano Legal Defense Fund. He will join our faculty on July 1st as a member of the Department of History. Mr. Gomez will be the moderator for the symposium. Juanito.
Thank you. being the second symposium, the theme being La Causa en Marcha, it is fitting that we begin it reading the most important document that the movement has published in the course of this year, the most significant statement that we have conceived in the last year. I refer, of course, to the Plan de Aztlán statement from the Denver Conference, the gathering of movement organizations that took place in Colorado 4 weeks ago. El Plan Espiritual de Aztlán. En el espíritu de una raza que ha reconocido no solo su orgullosa herencia histórica, sino también la bruta invasión gringa de nuestros territorios, nosotros, los chicanos, habitantes y civilizadores de la tierra norteña de Aztlán, de donde provinieron nuestros abuelos, solo para regresar a sus raíces y consagrar la determinación de nuestro pueblo del sol, declaramos que el grito de la sangre es nuestra fuerza, nuestra responsabilidad y nuestro inevitable destino. Somos libres y soberanos para señalar aquellas tareas por las cuales gritan justamente nuestra casa, nuestra tierra, el sudor de nuestra frente y nuestro corazón. Aztlán pertenece a los que siembran la semilla, riegan los campos y levantan la cosecha, y no al extranjero europeo. No reconocemos fronteras caprichosas en el continente de bronce. El carnalismo nos une y el amor hacia nuestros hermanos nos hace un pueblo ascendiente que lucha contra el extranjero gabacho que explota nuestras riquezas y destroza nuestra cultura. Con el corazón en la mano y con las manos en la tierra, declaramos el espíritu independiente de nuestra nación mestiza. Somos la raza de bronce con una cultura de bronce. Ante todo el mundo, ante Norteamérica, ante todos nuestros hermanos en el continente de bronce, somos una nación. Somos una nación de pueblos libres. Somos Aztlán. Okay, for those of you that are culturally deprived in the foreign language, the Plan de Aztlán, in the spirit of a new people that is conscious not only of its proud historical heritage, but also of the brutal gringo invasion of our territories, we, the Chicano inhabitants and civilizers of the northern land of Aztlán, from whence came our forefathers, reclaiming the land of their birth, consecrating the determination of our people of the sun, declare that the call of our blood is our power, our responsibility, and our inevitable destiny. We are free and sovereign to determine those tasks which are justly called for by our house, our land, the sweat of our brows, and by our hearts. Aztlán belongs to those that plant the seeds, water the fields, and gather the crops, and not to the foreign Europeans. We do not recognize capricious frontiers on the bronze continent. Brotherhood unites us, and love for our brothers makes us a people whose time has come, and whose struggle against the foreigner gabacho who exploits our riches and destroys our culture. With our heart in our hands in the soil, we declare the independence of our mestizo nation. We are a bronze people with a bronze culture. Before the world, before all North America, before all our brothers in the bronze continent, we are a nation. We are a union of free people. We are Aztlán, por la raza todo fuera de la raza, nada. A man whose acts have validated his deeds. A man who has raised the standard of our people in northern New Mexico. A man who struggles to give us all freedom. Leader of the Alianza, recognized amongst the leadership of the movement, Reyes Tijerino de Nuevo México.
Muchas gracias, caballeros y damas, y jovencitos y estudiantes. Es un placer y me da mucho gusto estar aquí entre ustedes. Yo creo que vamos a tener muchos oradores que van a hablar el inglés y yo creo que yo me voy a animar y voy a hablar español porque se está, entre más, se me está haciendo que estamos hablando mucho de nuestra cultura y nuestro idioma. Y estamos usando pura cortesía y diplomacia. Ya hemos usado cortesía por 120 años con nuestros hermanitos ojos azules. Y de cuando en cuando sería bueno lucir el brillo de nuestro idioma, lucir la fuerza, el calor de nuestro espíritu. Ustedes bien lo saben que el espíritu de un pueblo está en la idioma. Y si la cultura la clasificamos con números, entonces la idioma es el número uno de los números de nuestra cultura. Es la idioma y es la lengua la que causa guerras y la que causa paz. Con mover la lengua paramos la guerra y hacemos las guerras. Moviendo la lengua le hablamos a una novia y le prometemos y nos casamos con ella. Es la idioma, es la lengua. Y yo quisiera, si ustedes me permiten, en esta ocasión, hablar con mi alma y con mi corazón en la mano, es decir, con la idioma nuestra. Ya se está enmoheciendo, está congelándose o estaba congelada y es tiempo de derretir nuestra cultura, nuestro idioma, para que en verdad nuestro pueblo y nuestros hijos vayan recogiendo y acumulando valor, recogiendo y acumulando brío en su identidad, pues que sin idioma no hay identidad. Así es que también quiero extender las gracias a los que nos invitaron, Juan Gómez, Moctezuma Esparza y todos los otros jóvenes estudiantes, y el presidente del cuerpo estudiantil de la Universidad de California en Los Ángeles, Rosalío Muñoz. Me dicen que fue electo presidente del cuerpo estudiantil universitario de 22 años y pues quiero dedicarle al presidente del cuerpo estudiantil de la Universidad de California en Los Ángeles este discurso, esta lectura se la quiero dedicar al presidente del cuerpo estudiantil, Rosalío Muñoz. Caballeros y damas, el problema del suroeste es el problema del continente de bronce. La esperanza del continente hemisférico, el hemisferio occidental, es la esperanza del suroeste. El suroeste es el único pedazo de tierra en este continente donde hay un pueblo que habla inglés y que habla español. El suroeste es el lugar y las fronteras donde España y Inglaterra chocaron sus culturas y su odio que habían acumulado por 300 años. Por 300 años España dominó en este continente y dejó un pueblo nuevo. A España, nuestro padre, lo echaron fuera a patadas, pero se quedó el retoño, se quedó el pueblo aquí nuevo, el pueblo hispano, el pueblo que lleva en sus venas sangre española y sangre indígena. Y no digo de sangre de apaches nomás o navajoses, sino que de todas las cientos de tribus que hay en este continente. Así es que yo quiero decir que el suroeste contiene un pueblo especial, una raza especial. Y cuando salieron aquí los valientes estudiantes que vienen rompiendo las fronteras y descubriendo un nuevo camino para nuestro pueblo, y que sacaron el plan de Aztlán, el plan espiritual de Aztlán, pues me dio mucho gusto y se me llenó el corazón de alegría. Y yo creo, según me dicen, que Aztlán era el nombre del suroeste muchos años o siglos pasados. Así es que antes de ir más adelante, quiero decir que el suroeste se compone del pueblo con mejor cultura, con mejor fuerza, con mejor espíritu, con mejores planes, con mejor visión y con un destino que envuelve al continente entero, porque como diré y explicaré adelante, de aquí entre pocos años, tanto el blanco como el negro va a realizar el papel que va a desempeñar nuestro pueblo de bronce, y van a realizar que ningún otro pueblo tiene la balanza del poder, o va a causar que se tilde la balanza del poder más que el pueblo indohispano, mexicano, chicano, hispano. Yo hablo por la Alianza de Pueblos Libres, y como saben ustedes, la alianza comenzó y nació en Albuquerque, en Nuevo México, en el norte de Nuevo México. El espíritu de la alianza es el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo. Los gritos de aquel fenómeno, la fuerza congelada del Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo firmado entre los Estados Unidos y México el día 2 de febrero de 1848, es lo que parió y le dio vida y le dio luz a un movimiento que se llama ahora la Alianza. Así es que para nosotros, no solamente en Nuevo México, sino que en el suroeste, el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo encierra, no un misterio, pero encierra la fuerza legal, la fuerza constitucional, la chispa del espíritu que nos va a mover, no solamente a rascarle las orejas al adversario con marchitas, sino que a voltear el establecimiento al revés y traer un bautismo, si lo quieren, de agua, para que hablen los bautizados en español, o si no, de fuego, o si no, de sangre, pero será un bautismo. Mientras nuestro pueblo no realice lo que dice el artículo 6, sección 2 de la Constitución de los Estados Unidos, vamos a seguir rascándole la espalda al adversario y nos va a conformar como está conformando a muchos. Ya no leche de polvo en lugar de justicia, porque está quitando la leche y nos está dando estampidas, pero más allá nos va a conformar con trabajitos, con concesiones, con programas. El artículo 6, sección 2 de la Constitución de Nuevo México dice que todos los tratados internacionales hechos por Estados Unidos son la ley suprema de la nación. Entonces, en el artículo 6, sección 2, ningún anglo tiene una jota de derecho, porque ahí nomás el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo entra. Ahora, el anglo está en eminencia y el establecimiento está en eminencia porque ellos han levantado sus artículos de ellos, su constitución, aquellas partes que levantan el derecho de ellos, Pero el artículo 6, sección 2 va a quedar y va a seguir congelado mientras que nosotros no le demos vida y espíritu. El plan de Islam debe ser una ampolleta, una aguja para meterle sangre al plan de Islam. Y el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo y la respuesta. Debemos de pedir al gobierno, debemos de pedir a las universidades que apropien dinero para que se imprima el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo en masa y se publique. Y de tal manera que hasta en los basureros se hallen y se encuentren los tratados de Guadalupe Hidalgo, de tanto que yo haga, igualmente como ellos. Ellos cuando quieren y empujan un programa, desarrollan un plan para expropiar, para sangrar, engañar o hacer una guerra, llenan la tierra, el continente de panfletas y publicaciones en radio, la televisión y en el periódico. Así tenemos que hacer nosotros. De otro modo, el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo va a seguir durmiendo y juntamente con el tratado todos nuestros derechos. Por eso es que todavía, mis hermanos, seguimos rascándonos la cabeza y comenzamos en español y acabamos en inglés. Muchos creen que lo que pasó en Tierra Amarilla fue una casualidad, que lo que está pasando en Nuevo México fue una casualidad, que la defensa de Rey López Tijerina en la causa criminal más grande de la historia de Nuevo México, que sacudió el continente, creen que fue casualidad. No, el espíritu del Tratado Guadalupe Hidalgo desarrollado fue el que me dio valor en la sangre, me inspiró el corazón y el espíritu para defenderme solo. Si es que esto es lo que necesitamos, el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo. Pero es responsabilidad nuestra ponerle el valor que merece ese papel, ese documento. Aunque no sirva, como dicen a veces, pues si no sirve, entonces Estados Unidos no tiene derecho jurisdiccional o soberanía en el Southwest. Entonces está traspasando, porque el único documento de propiedad que él tiene para reclamar el Southwest es el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo, por eso se llama Tratado de Concesión, que México le cedió a los Estados Unidos el territorio del suroeste por el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo. Es la intención de ellos. Y hasta ahorita estaban muy contentos pensando que el tratado iba a permanecer durmiendo, congelado, y nosotros íbamos a seguir rescarbando o buscando por otros medios y por otros artículos. El artículo 2, sección, perdón, el artículo 6, sección 2, de la Constitución de los Estados Unidos dice: todos los tratados hechos por los Estados Unidos son la ley suprema de la nación. Mis hermanos, ahí está nuestra idioma española, castellana, envuelta en el artículo 6, sección 2. Ahí está nuestro valor. Nuestro machismo está escondido en el tratado y en el artículo 6, sección 2. Pero vamos a seguir nosotros haciendo como lo que hicieron aquellos ciegos. Estaban pidiendo limosna. Y luego le dice un gringo al otro: mira, ¿quieres tú que se peleen esos dos ciegos que parece que son hermanitos? Dijo: ¿cómo lo vas a hacer? Pues si no tienen, están ciegos, ¿cómo se van a pelear? Pues vas a verlo tú. Si arrimontaban los ciegos y les dicen voz recia, fuerte, para que los dos oyeran: tengan para los dos. Y no les dio nada. Entonces uno le dice al otro: oye, dame mi parte. Ya cuando se fue el malvado ojos azules, le dice el otro: no, dame la mía, si a ti te lo dio. Yo oí que dijo que era para los dos. No te hagas que. Y que comenzaron a pelear y a pelear. Y están peleando como los chicanos aquí en Estados Unidos. Llenos de envidia, llenos de celo, llenos de roña. Luego le dice aquel, dice: ahora, ¿quieres ver que paren de pelear? Pero ¿cómo? Si están rete enojados, están agarrándose los cabellos, mira nomás, pobrecitos. Dice: pues yo los paro. Pero ¿cómo les va a hacer? Vas a ver, vas a ver, si son muy pendejidos. Y fue y se arrime, fue y se arrima, y entonces le dice el ojos azules, le dice: oye, se están peleando dos ciegos. Híjole, dice, y uno de ellos está sacando un cuchillo, mira qué cuchillote está sacando. Y los dos ciegos creían que el otro estaba sacando el cuchillo y un ciego corrió para allá porque creía que el otro ciego traía el cuchillo. Y aquel ciego creía que el otro ciego estaba sacando el cuchillo y corrieron para y dejaron de pelear instantáneamente. Eso es exactamente lo que está haciendo nuestro Uncle Sam y nuestros establecimientos, nuestros programas, nuestros colegios, nuestras universidades, nuestros representantes, nuestros políticos, nuestros abogados, nuestros jueces y hasta los policías. Hay que decirle al gringo que ya tenemos ojos abiertos y ya no nos puede decir tengan para los dos. You can drop dead, les vamos a decir aquí en adelante, ¿verdad? Cuando nos digan tengan para los dos. Mis hermanos, yo me siento muy orgulloso, yo no sé cómo se sentirán ustedes, pero yo me siento muy, muy orgulloso. Muy orgulloso, muy satisfecho, muy seguro del destino y del futuro de esta nación. Porque no es lo fuerte y recio que vamos progresando nosotros para adelante, es lo recio que viene el anglo para atrás, es lo que cuenta. Y nosotros hay que también preparar nuestros hijos, preparar los libros de la historia en el futuro, para ya no envolver nuestras almas ni nuestra cultura con los crímenes establecidos por este establecimiento. No queremos tener parte ni suerte en los 60 millones de búfalos que el anglo mató por miedo a enfrentarse al indio en la batalla, afuera. Asesinó todos los búfalos para que el indio tuviera hambre y se rindiera de puro hambre. Y como han logrado en Estados Unidos, de puro hambre, han logrado que algunos comiencen a hacerse lambes y lambiscones y a llevar y traer, nomás por traer un carrito o un traje o cositas que no valen la pena. La prensa ha querido matar el progreso, la marcha de nuestro pueblo hacia el destino. Y así al día, cuando como dice el plan de Aztlán, que no habrá fronteras caprichosas políticas con diferentes nombres de Chile, Perú, México, etcétera, etcétera, sino que solamente un espíritu, un color, un idioma, un amor, un orgullo, un celo, pero el celo que no sea por nuestra águila y nuestro nombre o gloria personal, sino que sea ese celo consumidor por nuestro pueblo. De tal manera que al ver nosotros que estos policías cometen brutalidad y esas escuelas conforman a nuestros estudiantes con migajas vergonzosas, podamos hacer lo que dice Alejandro, el experto en la ley del arresto. Los estudiantes de ley, y entre ellos el que hablaba ahorita conmigo, hablaba un estudiante de ley, les diré que estudien los dos volúmenes, los dos tomos de Alejandro, el experto en la ley del arresto. Antes de arrestar nosotros o atentar a arrestar a Alfonso Sánchez, el procurador, leímos y estudiamos bien las leyes del arresto, donde dice, y ustedes pueden hacerlo, son dos volúmenes, por el Alexander, y busquen bajo las palabras the rights of citizens to make a citizen's arrest. Este fue el derecho, pero quiero que sepan que si el tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo, si el espíritu de Guadalupe Hidalgo, si el espíritu de la frontera y de bronce no hubiera estado en nosotros antes, nunca hubiéramos tenido pantalones, hubiéramos seguido conformándonos con marchitas de Albuquerque a Santa Fe, hubiéramos seguido conformándonos con walkouts, hubiéramos seguido conformándonos con payasadas. Pero dos marchas hicimos y creímos que ya era bastante, porque no hay que tampoco ridiculizar al que nos dice tengan para los dos y crea y siga creyendo que somos pendejíos. Hombres y mujeres, niños y ancianos, fueron, cuando nos pararon nuestra convención en Coyote, Nuevo México, fue este pueblo a la Casa de Cortes. Y fuimos a la Casa de Cortes porque ahí es donde está el asiento de la autoridad. Ahí es donde están está concentrado el poder como la leche, la crema que se recoge arriba de la leche. Así en la casa de corte Tierra María, ahí estaba concentrado el poder, ahí estaba el orgullo de los pistoleros, ahí estaba concentrado y recogido la autoridad del condado de Río Arriba. Y ahí fuimos porque ahí creímos que ahí se había escondido Alfonso Sánchez, un títere de los que no tienen ojos y que les dicen tengan para los dos, arrestarlo. Pero como ellos muy, muy acostumbrados, uno de los policías sacó la pistola cuando le dijimos ven para que sirvas de testigo porque venimos a arrestar a Alfonso Sánchez, el procurador, por haber violado los derechos civiles y haber cometido una felonía cuando paró la convención en Coyote, Nuevo México. Cuando el hombre fue por su pistola, otro de los caballeros, con mucho cariño, ¿verdad? Con lástima, pero tuvo que darle un balacito para que no sacara su pistolón. Ese fue Nick Size. Y luego Daniel Rivera sacó su pistolón y también le dieron con una de las cachas de las carabinas aquí nomás para no lastimarlo, solamente para quitarle la pistola que había sacado y cayó lleno de sangre. Se lo llevaron con el doctor. Luego el sherife Benny Naranjo, también según el testimonio, dice que él sacó la pistola y corrió para el hall y dice que ahí se topa con tijerina con un rifle en sus manos, dice, y me hizo así, me la tumbó de las manos y luego con el otro lado me dio aquí y caí desmayado. Bueno, natural que ellos como siempre trajeron la Guardia Nacional y comenzaron a concentrar toda la fuerza que las tasaciones de nosotros pueden recoger en la pistola, en el broche, en la autoridad y en la capital de Nuevo México. Ya saben ustedes el resto de la historia, ya es vieja y no quiero repetirla, lo que quiero decir es esto. Que todo el borlote y toda la guerra y toda la revolución y todo lo que se hizo en Tierra María el 5 de junio fue a parar en Albuquerque, Nuevo México, en la casa de corte, donde 5 gringos, 6 chicanos y un negro fueron el jurado que me juzgaron a mí. Ya ustedes también saben la respuesta, ¿verdad? En California le llamaron el Bloodless Coup, tijerina Bloodless Coup, porque allí no hubo sangre como en Tierra María. Fue una victoria total y limpia. Y desde ahí para acá, mis hermanos, quiero que sepan que los policías son gatitos finos, blancos, limpios, que lamben nomás. No, ya no lastiman a nadie. Por eso, mis hermanos, es que hay que saber primero la ley, hay que saber la verdad, hay que saber los derechos, antes de ir a arrestar a un hipócrita de estos, antes de después de ir y enforzar la ley. Pero mientras que nosotros en la universidad y en las escuelas chicas y los líderes sigan durmiendo y sigan conformándose con migajas, vamos nosotros a tener miedo a arrestar a estos hipócritas. Tenemos que conocer la ley, tenemos que conocer el derecho, tenemos que conocer la Constitución, tenemos que conocer lo que protege nuestra cultura y nuestra riqueza, que es el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo. Por eso les pido a ustedes ahora, estudiantes universitarios, que pidan y marchen si es posible, pero marchen para que el gobierno nuestro apropie millones para que se publique el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo, pero junto con el protocolo, porque él va a querer imprimir el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo sin el artículo 10 y sin el protocolo. Quiero que sepan que México no quiso firmar el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo hasta que antes no Estados Unidos consintió a escribir el protocolo. Es el protocolo el importante, mis hermanos. Es el protocolo el que está en mi corazón. Es el protocolo el que me hace gritar y me da confianza, no el tratado. El tratado es una vergüenza. El tratado es un escándalo. El tratado es, puesto que el que firmó el tratado, Nicolás Petris, ni poder tenía, porque sus credenciales de plenipotenciario ya las había revocado el presidente James Polk. Pero es el protocolo, mis hermanos. Y por amor a Dios, a su cultura y a su idioma, vamos uniéndonos y poniendo los ojos y el corazón en el futuro, no en los nombres ahorita en el 69, en el futuro y en las victorias que traerán a todos orgullo, victoria.
Victorias que alcancen hasta la Tierra del Fuego. Victorias que alcancen hasta Canadá, donde también los franceses luchan y pelean por su idioma. Victorias que llegue hasta África. No victorias, mis hermanos, que solo lo que hacen es levantar un líder o levantar el nombre de una organización o de un movimiento. No, queremos la victoria, hermanos míos, que mata las fronteras y quita los celos y las envidias. ¿Por qué no queremos trompezarnos con la misma bendición y la cultura que estamos defendiendo? Al contrario. Sí, nos vamos a encontrar con represalias, seguro que sí. Yo nunca había sentido el calor y el peso aplastador del odio del anglo antes de la victoria del día 13 de diciembre, que fue un día viernes, y en el número que el anglo dice que es bad number, bad luck, del 13. Pues sí fue luck, fue bad luck para él, pero para nosotros fue victoria. De ahí para acá, una voz me dijo en teléfono: te voy a volar de aquí, hijo del tal por cual. Y hasta entonces nos han echado 6 bombas. La última fue una bomba por un químico, nuclear physicist. No queremos que vayan a llevarle el chisme porque lo andamos cuidando, y no, y si él se da cuenta, se va a cuidar más. Queremos agarrarlo en el hecho. Así es que no le van a decir a nadie lo que estoy diciéndoles yo aquí. Pueden decirle lo demás, que fue una bomba de nitroglicerina. It was a nitroglycerin bomb. Destruyó 12 automóviles y en el periódico nomás pusieron el carro de Santiago Anaya porque lo hizo carne picada, pero destruyó 12 carros, 2 cuadras por cada lado, quebró todas las ventanas, y era un time bomb con time device para que cuando salieran de la junta el pueblo que estaba allí se volaran todos. Esto es la señal, hermanos míos, esta es la señal que el anglo, el enemigo, ha descubierto que ahora sí hay una amenaza contra él, como la hubo cuando mató y asesinó a Dr. King y a los hermanos Kennedy. Pero no pensamos nosotros dormirnos, ni tampoco ponernos de target para que él dispare las balas. No. Se le va a voltear el chirrión al revés con nosotros, porque somos muy... Mis hermanos, yo que quería, por si acaso es la última vez, quería yo este día poner énfasis en el Tratado Guadalupe Hidalgo. Porque ahí conocerá el anglo si hemos despertado o no hemos despertado. El anglo es un hombre educado. El establecimiento es un hombre que se mueve como computadora por botones y law and order. Pero tiene el corazón petrificado, como el petrified wood. Tiene el corazón petrificado, causa la computadora, y ya no responde a los sentimientos humanos, ya no responde a las relaciones cósmicas, que también es lo que son las relaciones humanas. Y nosotros somos los responsables. Si el Tratado de Guadalupe ya lo continúa, nomás mencionándose en Nuevo México, o en Texas, o en California nomás, vamos mal, vamos a tener que hacer. El negro sabe ¿dónde ponerla y concentrar el valor y la fuerza? ¡Todos! Seguro que habrá varios líderes negros, pero todos dicen ¡Black is beautiful! Y así nosotros, aunque tengamos varios líderes o varias organizaciones, el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo debiera de ser nuestra nota principal. Este es lo que más quisiera yo dejar escrito de recuerdos en sus mentes y en sus corazones. Porque de nada sirven los pantalones solos y el valor solos sin sesos acá arriba. Necesitamos mucha hombría, machismo, pero también necesitamos entendimiento y sabiduría, conocimiento de las leyes. ¿Ustedes creen que después de que les el escandalazo que hizo la prensa y los cobardes políticos en Nuevo México, que me amaron hasta un hombre horrible me pusieron para explicar la razón por qué metieron la Guardia Nacional. Porque ya había comenzado la gente a decir, bueno, pero ¿por qué para cuando unos cuantitos hombres pobrecitos allá en la sierra mandaron 3,500 soldados y los tanques y helicópteros y todo eso y los perros y la policía y montada y en jeep? ¿Por qué? Ah, dijeron ellos, porque andábamos detrás del King Tiger. Ellos inventaron el nombre. Nadie me ha dicho a mí King Tiger de mis hermanos. Nadie me había dicho a mí. Ellos lo inventaron para explicar su cobardía. Para explicar la razón por qué usaron tanto poder. Sí, para que después dijeran, ah, con razón usaron la Guardia Nacional. Pues también aquel hombre es un tigre. Si no era tigre, si era una borreguita. Nomás que esa borreguita, pues también he aprendido mucho del anglo. A veces traigo la lana blanca y a veces en lugar de ser lana es una concha de tortuga. Y esto es, mis hermanos, lo principal. De otro modo, nunca vamos a avergonzar a nuestro gobierno. Nunca lo vamos a avergonzar. Noten ustedes que él, para hacer la guerra en Vietnam y para hacer esto, y dice, we have to keep our commitments in Vietnam. And we have to keep our commitments with our and the treaty of Europe, with Europe. Y puros treaties. Y ahí sí saca la ley, ahí sí saca los comités, la constitución y los tratados. Y nosotros, con tanto poder, con tanta gloria, con tanta documentación, con tanto derecho. Por eso el jurado dijo que yo era inocente, porque usé la ley. Porque tenemos derecho no solamente de arrestar a estos hijos del demonio, sino que también, mis hermanos. Sino que también castigarlos. Vaya a Tierra María, vaya a ese lugar y verá que a unos los haya con cicatrices aquí, a otros con cicatrices acá y creo que hasta Nixay hasta nos está metiendo un suit con por $1,500,000 para que le paguemos por el balazo. ¿Qué les parece, eh? Idiota, estúpido, sin saber que el jury le dijo al mundo entero que yo era inocente y que habíamos tenido nosotros derecho de arrestarlos y usar la máxima fuerza para ejecutar el arresto, porque así dice la ley. Y así le instruyó el juez Larrazolo, le instruyó al jurado. Antes de que el jurado entrara a la cámara de jurado para deliberar mi destino, le dijo el jurado, the people of New Mexico have the right to make a citizen's arrest. They also have the right to use whatever force is necessary to perform such an act. Así que los policías quedaron haciendo pucheros. Le pregunté yo a uno de los policías, le dije, ¿conoces tú la ley de Alejandro, la explicación sobre el derecho de arresto? No. ¿Conoces tú los derechos civiles? No. ¿Sabías tú que el pueblo civil te puede arrestar a ti? No. ¿Te ha instruido el District Attorney a ti sobre los derechos del pueblo? No. Entonces, ¿no crees tú que así como estás ignorante con una pistola en la calle, eres una amenaza para el público? Yes, dijo. Así dijo. Y miren el transcript. Algún día vamos a circular el testimonio y verán que dijo, well, I guess. Por eso es, mis hermanos, que es bueno conocer la ley, conocer el derecho. Porque si los ciegos siguen a un ciego, todos van a caer en un pozo. Y el pueblo es necesario que siga a hombres con ojos, a hombres que entienden la ley, que entienden la constitución y su interpretación, para que no anden siguiendo a gente que nomás porque gritan, que nomás porque hablan, que nomás porque acá y allá creen que son unos hombres con valor. Es bonito, natural. El valor es bonito, ciego, con ojos o sin ojos, sordo, como sea, como dijo el chango. No talk, no, no see, no, no, no hear. Pero como quiera, el valor es bueno. Pero no para poner en peligro nuestro destino. Mis hermanitos, el suroeste es el terreno donde vamos a tener que establecer universidades bilingües, donde se enseñe la cultura anglosajona, el inglés y el español. Porque en el futuro, quiero que los que no sepan o saben, sepan que nuestra raza, así está escrito en el cielo y así le plació a Dios, como dicen las estadísticas internacionales y nacionales, que el pueblo que va produciendo más rápido per cápita es el chicano, es el pueblo hispano, latino. Más rápido vamos multiplicándonos que China y que India. Para el año 2000, dicen las estadísticas, el pueblo de bronce tendrá 600 millones aquí en este continente hemisférico. ¿Sabían ustedes? ¿Sabían ese hecho? ¿Se los han dicho aquí en la escuela a ustedes? Entonces, si no sabían, ahora que lo saben, comienzan a sentir que no somos una minoría. Cuando alguien les diga que the Southwest has 3.5 million y 5.5 million y 7.5 million, dígale, Tejela, I'll fight a whole day with you to prove that we have 15 million. The hell is your organized conspiracy and lies. Ya basta de mentiras. El anglo sabe más que muchos de nosotros sobre la riqueza, la fortuna, sobre la cultura nuestra y el futuro que tenemos nosotros aquí. Él sabe bien el contenido del Tratado Guadalupe Hidalgo. Por eso ha estado bloqueando y saboteando que no se imprima, que no circule, que no caiga el Tratado y el Protocolo en manos de estos rebeldes con causa, porque se van a volver, si ahorita queman un carro sin conocer sus derechos, mañana van a conocer a quemar 1,000 carros, o quién sabe cuántos, solo Dios sabrá. Porque están rebeldes. Están rebeldes. Quiere probar su rebeldía, venga el día 5 de junio a Nuevo México. Vamos a celebrar el segundo aniversario de Tierra María. El día que le quitamos los pantalones a los policías. El día que le regresamos el valor y el corazón a nuestro pueblo. Ese día 5 de junio. Ese día vendrá la liberación del primer pueblo, de los 1,700 pueblos libres que debe de haber aquí. Porque no es justo que nuestro gobierno nomás respete los pueblos libres de los indios y los pueblos libres del indo-hispano no los proteja. No es justo, mis hermanos. Si va a proteger al indio, tiene que proteger también nuestros derechos idénticos al del indio. Porque las leyes de las Indias, que documentan a nuestro idioma y documentan a nuestra cultura, lo especifica, que los pueblos de los indios fueron formados, nacieron bajo la misma ley, bajo la misma protección, bajo los mismos valores y principios que los pueblos que establecieron y formaron los chicanos, los indohispanos, los mexicanos y toda la raza de bronce, para no hablar tantos nombres, la raza de bronce, vaya. José Vasconcelos, 100 años atrás, escribió un libro que le llama La Raza Cósmica. También ese libro no lo podemos encontrar porque el anglo no quiere que nuestros hijos lo lean. Porque ahí es donde dice que la raza de bronce va a dominar aquí el continente. No con balas, ni con cañones, ni con bombas de mostaza. ¿O cómo se llaman estas otras bombas que está echando allá? Napalm. No, sino que vamos a dominar, hermanos, con la cultura, con los números, con la paz, con el ejemplo, con la influencia, con la justicia. Vamos a dominar. Les aseguro que para ese tiempo, cuando domine la raza de bronce, el que saque una carabina o amenace con un cuchillo, lo van a colgar en el público, no en la cámara, en el público, para que a otro no le queden ganas de andar así echando valentías con cuchillo y pistola. El buen gallo, donde quiera canta y sin pistola y armas, enseña su corazón y sus pantalones. La vergüenza es... La vergüenza es que hoy en día los gatos pasan por liebres por la simple razón que nomás porque las muchachas ven al hombrecito con pantalones se casan con él. Después que están en la cama descubren que no eran hombres. Pero eso resulta a causa de que el anglo nos ha castrado, como dice la poesía de Jorge González. Nos ha castrado, nos ha rompido, nos ha congelado y no quiere que descubramos el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo. No quiere que descubramos la ley, la letra, la historia, la verdad, que lo va a sentenciar a él por hipócrita, por traidor y por cobarde. Enséñenme ustedes las evidencias de que nosotros somos un pueblo cobarde o que somos un pueblo injusto o cruel. La campana de la libertad que está en Filadelfia, Pensilvania, que la vi 2 semanas pasadas, la fui a ver y a tocar con mi madre, a ver si era verdad, porque leí la historia que se quebró 3 veces. Y cada vez que el gringo, como lee la Biblia, donde dice la Biblia, Dios no puede ser burlado de nadie, y es muy cristiano el anglo, pues entonces, cada vez que le pegaba la campana para decirle al mundo y engañar al mundo que había, que este era the land of the free, que let freedom ring throughout the world, se quebraba la campana. Y le volvía a pegar otra vez, la derretía y le echaba más oro y le echaba más bronce y más plata y le pegaba otra vez y se crebaba. Pero era que el grito de los negros en cadenas era más recio, sonaba más fuerte que el grito de la campana, por eso se quebraba la campana. Así es que la campana está ahí como evidencia de que él es un hipócrita desde que fundó aquí, desde que fundó este llamado The Land of the Free. Bueno, hay muchos oradores y si sigo hablando no van a oír a los demás con gusto. A mí no me gusta hablar al último. Ahora que fui a Nueva York a hablarle a los National Lawyers Guild, 1,200 abogados, me dejaron para el último para que no se fuera nadie. Pero me peleé con el director, le dije, oye, le dije delante de la gente, ¿qué me das? ¿Un pueblo cansado, un pueblo dormido, un pueblo fastidiado? ¿Tú crees que me van a oír? Se rieron todos, pero gritaron que sí me oirían porque querían oír el grito del norte, de Tierra María, la victoria de la corte, donde el primer hombre hizo una revolución y se defendió y lo declararon inocente. Y eso haremos, mis hermanos. Si conocemos el derecho y la ley, podremos hacer una revolución verdadera y llevarla a la corte y ahí también ganarla. La ganamos afuera y la ganamos adentro. Porque ese día la ganamos nosotros en Tierra María y también la ganamos en la corte de Albuquerque. Y recuerden también que sin el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo no habrá tierra, y sin tierra no hay madre, no hay espíritu, no hay sustancia. Todo el orgullo de la nueva generación, toda la fuerza, todos los sueños nuestros salen de la tierra. Y es la tierra la única que no nos roba ni nos traiciona. Todo lo que hace el hombre, computadoras, televisiones, carros, casas, se queman, se acaban, se funden los focos, pero la tierra no se quema ni se acaba. Todos los años nos da zacate, nos da leche, nos da vaquitas, y cada vaca tiene otra vaquita cada año, y la tierra cada año da fruta. Esa es mi madre, y por ella voy a pelear yo. Muchas gracias y adiós. Si creen que estuvo muy bonito y que el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo vale la pena, vamos a levantar una colecta para imprimir el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo. Van a pasar por allá los muchachos y echen un peso para imprimir el Tratado de Guadalupe Hidalgo. Muchas gracias.
Reyes López Tijerina, de Nuevo México. Okay. The Braves will pass through the aisles making a collection for the Alianza, specifically for the thing they're trying to do on June 5th. They need funds. We wish to thank UMass of UCLA for making this possible. We also wish to welcome all the community and movement organizations here. Amongst them, the East LA Welfare Rights Organization, the Educational Issues Coordinating Committee, La Junta, UMass Chapters, Lucha, La Raza Association, Chicano Student Movement, La Verdad, CPA newspaper from San Diego, members of the Crusade from Denver, after the wrapping, around 2 o'clock, there'll be a general question and answer period. And after that's over, there'll be a reception on the third floor of Kirchhoff Hall for all of you who want to get together. Third floor, Kirchhoff Hall, around 2:30. La vida nueva. Right. As we know, more people arriving, their organizations will call out the names. Luis Arroyo is, taking care of that. And as we get them up here, we'll read them out. Nationalism is the concept that cuts across the entire community. It's a call for the forging of unity, a call to our heritage. It's a call to struggle to liberate our people here in the Southwest. A man who has been speaking on Chicano nationalism since the beginning of the Crusade for Justice. A man who is looked up to by all militant organizations in the Southwest. A man who is especially appealing to the youth. Un hombre como los de aquellos. Un hombre de coraje y responsabilidad, de orgullo y dignidad. Máximo representante de la Cruzada por la Justicia de Denver, Colorado. Rodolfo Corky González.
El plan espiritual de Aztlán desarrolla el tema que el chicano, la raza de bronce, debe usar su nacionalismo como la llave común para la organización en masa de la gente y sido cometido a la idea y filosofía del plan de Aztlán, podemos solamente concluir que la independencia social, económica, cultural y política es el único camino hacia la liberación total de la opresión, explotación y el racismo. Por esto, nuestra lucha de ver por el control de nuestros barrios, nuestros campos, nuestros pueblos, nuestras tierras, nuestra economía, nuestra cultura y nuestra vida política. El plan compromete todos los niveles de sociedad chicana, el barrio, el campo, el ranchero, el escritor, el maestro, el obrero, el profesional, los compromete a la causa. The plan de Aztlán was written first, the spiritual part was written by poets, was written by beautiful people of compassion, written by young men who recognize that liberation comes only when people are brave enough to stand up and call themselves a man or a woman. En el plan, after we got through with the conference, the young poets, the young minds got together and come up with El Plan Espiritual de Aztlán. And then we came up with a program to control ourselves, a program to liberate ourselves, a program to make Chicanismo, Carnalismo, a real living thing, a program of love, and at the same time, a program of real existence. So we have to look at the total life. We have to look at ourselves, and we have to look in the mirror, and we have to wonder who we are, and we have to tell ourselves the truth. And how many of us can? How many of us have all those hang-ups that the gringo has placed on our back? We can shout Viva la Raza and wear boycott buttons and still help the man out. We can shout liberation and still be oppressed and still be a slave to the man. So the only way that we're able to really come together and really cut all of the fat off and really bring our minds together is by looking at ourselves and saying, who are we? What do we want? We want 350 horsepower Thunderbird. We want to look like somebody stepped out of Esquire. I look like somebody stepped out of Vogue. We want to kill ourselves to have yellow hair. We want to walk in the shade so we don't get as dark. You know, we have to start analyzing what this gringo society has done to us. And we're finding out faster than they are in our fatherland, Mexico. Because the green fingers of money and exploitation are now strangling Mexico at this moment. And the tomatoes that they say are coming from Mexico are coming from gringo agribusiness to defeat the farm worker, the campesino, in his efforts to organize. And you see any of the latest cines de Mexico that most of their actors are blonde? They're leading people, and they don't know they're being jibed. They don't know that psychologically they're starting to destroy them. And psychologically they're starting to put racism into Mexico to where el indio is a second-class citizen, and the mestizo is a second-class citizen, y el blanco rubio is a powerful, strapping, successful symbol. And that's what they've been bullshitting us about all these years in our school books. And they've been telling us that all the success symbols are white, and all the success symbols are gringos. And they've been denying us our culture, our history, and our contributions. And we've been allowing it. And we've been going over there and trying to act like somebody we're not. And we've been trying to, some of the cats are even trying to sing like James Brown, you know, because they're not identifying with their own culture. What's all right, soul music is beautiful. And we should be able to integrate that and enjoy it. But Chicano soul music is beautiful too. And then we have the other cats that are trying to act like Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin and walking around like Steve McQueen and John Wayne, you know, trying to identify with somebody they're not, allowing this society to castrate us and to make us less a man. Because anytime you don't know who you are, anytime you don't know where you come from, anytime that you deny your mother and your father, and the cat that don't have no father, you know what he is. And anytime that you deny your own identity, you don't know who you are. You have no value, you have no worth. And that's why it's very important. It's very important that we speak in the colleges. Isn't it rather odd that most of the cats you've been calling to rap at all the college symposiums are not college people? You're starting to get some college heavies. You're having them up here. Cesar Chavez is not a college graduate nor a college movement person. Reyes Tijerina didn't come off a college campus, and I didn't either. You see, the reason I want to talk to young people in the colleges is very important. We don't come here to try to glorify ourselves. If we influence and if we create something, that's a satisfaction that anybody that can write poetry, paint a picture, play a song, make music and make love, anybody that can create, that's a satisfaction. And we want to create out of the young people an understanding of who you are and where you owe your leadership to, your ideas, your bodies, your brains, and your professions, and that you have to take them back home. And the college student has been isolating himself from the barrio. In California, I see one of the most advanced student movements of college Chicanos in all of the United States in the Southwest. I see the most advanced movement, and I see the most depressing movement within the community. And there must be some reason that there is not a communication. There is not an involvement. The college student cannot carry the banner of La Causa, of the problems of the barrio, as his banner and never associate with the barrio. And we can. And they cannot intellectualize the farm worker's problems and be proud and happy that he's liberating the campesino by wearing a boycott button. He has to become active in helping, active in organization, active and making sure that he spreads the message and he preaches and he teaches wherever he goes, and that he, one man is la causa, one man is the message, and all of us are la raza. And that each one of us start to come together and understand that we're one people, because we're responsible. Forget this stuff they tell you in the schools about the individualist can make it as long as he conforms to society. Because that's why we get so many vendidos walking out of these colleges with degrees and diplomas, because they say, I made it, and baby, I'm escaping. And they use that thing as a boat and row themselves right out of Raza Town and Razaville. And they don't look back until there's a Chicano studies program. Then they come back and say, I'm the man. It's paying twice as much as I'm making now. You see? We cannot fall into the bag. This administration knows, and this establishment knows. They know that as the Mexicano gets mad and starts to move, and if he ever nationalizes and organizes, he's going to be one of the toughest people he ever tied into, one of the toughest groups. Because the Mexicano is a guerrillero by nature. And when he finds this out, and he knows it, and this is why the mass media doesn't say nothing about us. The mass media doesn't tell you that the Brown Berets were bombed. The mass media doesn't tell us that the arena was bombed. They don't tell you the crusade was almost burned. They don't tell you that two farm workers, nonviolent organizers, are butchered by the Texas Rangers. They don't tell you that two revolutionary brothers, and let's change our opinions and our points of view, that those acts of the people of the barrios who have to face the changos day and night, our acts of revolution and not criminal acts. And when there was one wiped out in Mission, that was a revolutionary act, and give it some grace and give it some pride, and that those young boys will go down as political revolutionary heroes, not as criminals to rot in a prison. And you understand. You understand that we have been jived into looking at ourselves and being ashamed. How long was it before the Mexicanos were scared to walk in a picket line? Or they walked by a picket line, looked the other way, bad show. How many years ago was it that we were afraid to sit in, to stand in? But one Mexicano on an individual basis would not take a push from any policeman, any pig, any chango in this town. And that's why we ended up brutalized. But also, the rest of the Mexicanos didn't come out and tell that policeman why. And you're going to have to face us all. And that's mass movement. And that hasn't been done. And it's starting to be done. I'm happy to say it happened in Denver, where our kids had a blowout. They put us in jail and maced us and gassed us and a lot of those other little things that happen in demonstrations when you meet these people that are supposedly taking care of law and order, macing peaceful demonstrators and picketers picketing for unions and nonviolent organizers and young students demonstrating for a better education. And they mass up all of their white cars, and they mass up all of their blue suits, and they bring out their gas, and they bring out their helicopters, and they're taking care of law and order. And crime in Denver went up 23% on the 7-day walkout over there, because they didn't have to put up with any changos. They were all down there trying to break the heads of Chicano kids. But the Chicano kids, when they got through with them, had wiped out 25 police cars and put 17 cops in a hospital. But the one message that we had been trying to get across and the philosophy we spread of mass movement, mass nationalization, mass thought and philosophy hadn't come about because we were preaching and preaching and preaching. And the only people that came, we helped, and then we didn't see them anymore. Well, 50 young Chicanos from North Side, West Side, East Side forgot all about the gangs, forgot all about the barrio differences, and came together and wiped those policemen out. They chased 50 of them into the projects, which is 90% Chicano, and 900 Chicanos ran out of those doors and chased the policemen away. And that was finally mass philosophy. You know, that was finally mass movement. And out of those, you know, we say, we listen to the radicals, and we listen to the third world guy, people, and they say, third world means humanity. Third world means love. And we can agree with it. Because the Mexicanos already got all that. He doesn't have to rationalize and intellectualize. He already has it. He already has that warmth and that beauty. He already has that love. You know, so we've been a little too kind. We opened our doors and they come in and took everything. But we have that concept without intellectualizing it. And then the radical cat says, we must pragmatize and plan. And it's true, you have to have plans. You have to have ideas to guide you. You have to have reason. You have to have inspiration. So, but one thing happens. The action gets ahead of all the planning. We were planning to educate all the kids in the parks and the barrios, set up little liberation outposts and defense units all across the city of Denver, because the police have now become an army dealing against what they consider an army. And they are now passing laws to make it against the law for any three people to congregate. That's an assembly. If you have the materials for a Molotov cocktail, then that's a violation of an ordinance. So if you have an empty bottle of wine, you drink wine, I do, in the back of your car and a tank full of gas, then you have the materials and the tools for a Molotov cocktail. So one of our guys said, well, man, the next thing they're going to do, they're going to pass one against rape because we carry the equipment. But in all of confrontation with the establishment always sets barriers. Now, the fact that you can set up a citizen's arrest, and that Reyes y Arena was successful, will mean that very quickly there will be legislation against it. Let me tell you that. The fact that we can assemble, they've filed legislation against it immediately. They've already put legislation into effect to put policemen on the campuses. You've heard Nixon's statements and his Attorney General Mitchell's statements. You hear the police chief's statements that they will keep law and order, so that, which means that most college students must be thieves, you know, and committing criminal acts and some of these other things, because that's what they're talking about when they talk about law and order. And they're going to put policemen, they're going to put changos into the universities and the schools. They're going to force the school system to become penal institutions. In Denver, when the West High kids walked out, they locked all the Chicano kids in all the other schools. But some of them jumped out the windows. They put policemen at the doors. But kids from 16 and 18 schools walked out to support that one Chicano movement. And that nationalized us. And the police come down on us and beat our heads and maced us. And that organized us. It polarized us. And we came together. And it made a big difference. And we didn't have to preach about racism. We didn't have to go around saying, you know, the honky thinks that you're a speck. You know, the honky proves it by showing you Frida Bandidos. You know, the honky shows you by telling you about your history, which means that you were a greasy Mexican that the Texas Rangers shot down and ran down. You know, they keep telling you this. And the guy says, nah, I don't have no inferiority complex, man. There ain't nothing wrong with me. He says, I've got it made. I make $2.60 an hour. I'm a roofer. And I believe in the war in Vietnam because I was in the service. Then you ask him, why'd you go to the service? He says, well, I couldn't get a job. Oh, yeah? He says, why didn't you finish school? He says, well, I didn't like it. They didn't like me. So I quit to get a job. You couldn't get a job. You couldn't make it. You couldn't finish your education. But you could pass a test to go to the service. You're really brilliant. You really made it. And they institutionalized him. And he become part of the armed forces. Then he comes back, and he's making $2.60 an hour, and he thinks he's free. But he can't go to any other joint except a Chicano joint. And he looks at me and he says, and don't call me brown either. He says, I'm a white man. And I told him, man, I says, you're blacker than I am and you want to be a white man. And Cassius Clay's whiter than I am and he's a black man. Now we better, you know, get an understanding about what we are. So we start talking culture, history. We start discussing who we are. And we start understanding that when we really look into our history, we start finding all the beautiful things about us. Maybe everything wasn't beautiful. Maybe everybody wasn't good. Part of us is the Español, el Gauchupin. Part of us are the Huertas, and part of us are the Cortés, and part of us is Cuauhtémoc. Part of us is all parts, and we're all, what I wrote in my poem, we're all Joaquin. And we make up la raza. And we have started to nationalize ourselves and to stop fooling ourselves. That the gringo is not going to give you open doors unless he can control you and push buttons on you. And you better understand that. You better understand that when you sit in and demonstrate for more Chicano students in here, they're going to give them to you, so go ahead and do it. But don't let those Chicano students become some of those brainwashed holders of BAs and MAs. Make them Chicanos. When they come out of here, they know what they're supposed to do and they know their job. And their job is this, that in the barrios controls. School boards who live in the country club area control the educational system and the administration, the personnel, and the counselors, and the nurses, and everybody else out of the school system in the barrio. And we say it belongs to the barrio, and it's going to stay there. And it's going to be taken over if it has to be taken over by force, because you have that right. And people say, that's not a good thing to say, man. You know those new laws are passing. But you see, I read a lot. I just take those little things that I like. And you know, good thing Abraham Lincoln isn't alive today. He'd be doing time for causing riots and civil disorder. You know, because he said that the institutions are made to serve the people. And if they don't serve the people, then the people have the right to revolution and to destroy those institutions. So in the barrios, where the agencies, whether they're OEO, whether they're labor department, whether it is a recreation center, a school, whether it's a church, it belongs to the people. And let the people take it over. And let the barrio vatos be the defense corps that enforces it through nationalism and love and carnalismo. That's what it's all about. We must control ourselves. And we have to give the barrio vato, the little guy that's 10, 11 years old, that's being harassed by the police every day, we have to give him dignity. We have to give him pride. There will no longer be any acts of juvenile delinquency. There's going to be only acts of revolutionary acts. And that's going to be the difference. Our kids aren't going to fill those reform schools with Mexicanos for truancy and for violation of curfew or sniffing glue or stealing hubcaps. Give him a cause. Give him his people. Give him the love and give him the dignity to understand that he protects his own. And then you have a man. And then you have women. And then you have something solid. And then you understand, for those of you who aren't too physically inclined to go out in the alley and do it, El vato is. And he's on that front line. In New Mexico, they have los Comancheros in the campos. And they're the front line defense of the people who are being double-talked and pushed away at the welfare offices, are being pushed around in the district courts, are being shoved around with their taxes, and they become the front line. In Denver, it's Los Gallos de la Cruzada. And policemen know there that they do not disrespect us because we do not preach violence. And we don't preach nonviolence. We preach self-defense. And self-defense means that when a chango comes to get rid of you, he has a 50% chance of getting rid of. And that's why you know that when there's a bank robbery, policemen always get there 20 minutes too late. Because a bank robber is a professional, he knows what he's going to do. And he's going all the way. And he knows how to use that piece. So policemen usually get there just a little too late. And that's where respect starts to develop. So that when we start to control our barrios and the agencies, and people go around saying, yeah, but you know, you feel bad, you're on welfare, second-class citizen, because all the majority society says you are. No, give some new pride to our people on welfare. That is not a handout, that's reimbursement and restitution for all the sweat and blood we've given this society. And then you preach this. Only $8 billion is given to social services and welfare out of the total national budget. And agribusiness, the farmers get $38 billion, and they don't call that welfare, for not growing food to feed poor people. Senator Eastman in Mississippi gets $157,000 not to plant cotton in the poorest county in Mississippi, where people are starving, barely getting $60 a month for welfare with 5 and 6 and 8 kids. And that's not welfare. And Standard Oil gets all their tax depletions. You see, but that's not welfare. They buy tankers under other national flags not to pay taxes. And then if one South American country gets their machismo up and their nationalism up and start to shove the mothers out, what happens? They can call the U.S. Marines to go in there and enforce a private company on a free national sovereign country. And they're the guys that pay to get a man like Che Guevara killed and brag about it in True Magazine. They're the people that want us to breed more little Mexicanos so they can give us 42 cents a month out of welfare to educate them so that they can become Green Berets and paratroopers and they can become special forces, real vatos, real machos, who always have to, you know, when they get out there, then they remind you you're half Indian. Trujillo hit the point. Takes a lot of guts to get out there. But they want us to go sooner or later to South America to kill our mestizo brothers. That's right. Before my son goes, Before I pay 1 cent in taxes, we're going to get the guys who make the orders. We're not going to go down there to face and kill our brothers. One of the other areas that we're talking about, when we talk about control, those people who exploit the barrio, get rid of them out of the barrio. And if they're Chicanos that are exploiting, then make them understand that they're not going to exploit anymore. They're going to become nationalistic or else. And that's what it's going to be. In our town, we have a vendido who has a radio station, really a sellout. This guy is from Mexico originally, and he found out politically that it's easier to say he's Spanish-American over there now. And this is the battle some of us have. A lot of people think they're Hispano without being part Indio. And he has a radio station, and when we want an announcement to the people, we send our own radio announcer down to let him know that we're going to have an announcement about a rally or a demonstration, because we send a few guys down to see him. And he's very friendly with them. And now we have our own radio announcer for our own announcements, because that's the only Chicano station there is. Now, when we come down to the other things that we're involved with in El Plan, that we must have economic control, that we have to start understanding that we aren't the enemy, that barrio gangs have to understand that they're all Chicanos and who the enemy is, and you teach him who the enemy is. You teach him who the exploiter is. You teach him what the educational system is. When he starts learning that, he starts looking over there across the street instead of looking next door at the guy next door who looked at his chick and he wants to meet him down the street and they're going to kill each other. No, we have to start breaking that down. And the only way this happens is by creating action. And the action comes from learning something. So, El Plan de Aztlán becomes a name. It's our territory, it's our liberation. We want it seen everywhere. Write it in the heads. Put it on the underpasses. We're going to put it on trees. We're going to stick it on the bars. We're going to nail it on the courthouse doors. We're going to put it on the Forest Service. We're going to put it on churches. And if a little kid wants burritos instead of peanut butter and jelly and a Head Start program, he's going to take El Plan de Aztlán to get it with. And it's going to become the one thing that we can start to mobilize around. It's the one thing that we can start to think about. But what about action? Because you see, we plan things and the action gets ahead of us. Kids that demonstrate in a demonstration end up learning more in 3 days and 7 days than they can in all of the planning and teaching we try to do. And pretty soon they're the leaders, and they're wrapping the philosophy, and they're directing the movement, and pretty soon they're changing the whole school system. And they do it. So the first point of El Plan of Acción is to get Aztlán on the lips of every Mexicano. There's one Mexicano or a million, Aztlán is there. Get it on their lips, their ears. Hear it on the radio. Those of you who speak, say it again, spread it. It's ours, it's us. And then, who knows if September the 16th, the birthday of Mexican liberation, that one of the biggest and greatest and most directed and organized walkout in the history of this country, from Head Start to Head Start teachers, to college students, to obreros, to professionals and workers, will be the biggest mass boycott in the history of this nation, to change the educational system to relate to us and for us to control our own schools and to direct our own life. And it can be done. if we decide today that we're going to do it. And we start to plan and think. And I know and have already gotten confirmation from black brothers who say, right on, we're with you. And I've had words from the Anglo radicals that are willing to back it up on a support basis, because they now realize that we have taught that we use nationalism to create our own leadership, to create our own ideas and our own decisions. So I want to read something to you. And this was written in the 1910 Mexican Revolution by Juan Saravia. And he said that the publication of a revolutionary paper is equal to the taking of a city. The proclamation of a political plan is the same as the bloodiest combat. They form equal parts of a rebellion and are inherent in it. I have never seen, nor will I ever see, a revolution without the propagation of ideas as a preliminary and the shedding of blood as inevitable, as the inevitable means of deciding the outcome. And we know this, that when we walk out, when we demonstrate, there comes the law and order changos to say, you are violating the law, you don't have the right to demonstrate, you don't have the constitutional right of assembly, and they're going to start using their mace and their blackjacks and their clubs, and they're going to do something else. They're going to organize us. And they're going to show us racism in one day. They're going to show it to everybody. And we won't have to preach to the guy that police brutality exists. And he goes around saying, nah, it doesn't exist. Then one day they split him across the head. He says, you know what? There's police brutality in this town. And I'm against it. And I'm for anything you guys are for. Okay, it'll happen. It has to happen. And if it doesn't happen, psychologically, because they know it's already going out all over the country, the school is breaking their back, the system, to try to meet the demands before we even get to next fall. And that's what we want. But we also want the liberation of our society, our control of our own lives, and the young people have to go out and do it. And if we preach nationalism, let's be sure that we do. You know, let's not talk Chicano by night, rather by day, and sleep white by night. I want to add one other thing that's very important. In the past, we've had civil rights leaders and civil rights movements. We've had people boycotting things. We've had people striking for better unions and more money. We've had people demonstrating at the schools. And while the adults, the men, were out there, they left their women home, rapping on the telephone about petty gossip. And while he was learning about the system and learning about how to fight it, the old lady was get rid of the whole raza. And that's the important thing, that we're one people and we're going to move that way at all times. Thank you.
Viva Corky Gonzalez! Muy bien. ¡Viva Corky González! ¡Viva la Cruzada!
Nuestro pueblo es un pueblo de valentía y de hermosura. Una de las cosas más bellas y más queridas para nosotros es el arte. Pero más de cosa bella, el arte también puede ser una arma. Art can be an arm in the struggle. From the Teatro Chicano, from the Teatro Campesino, from the Teatro Urbano, from the Teatro Frontera, our people draw laughter and tears, strength and determination. The group that has led the way in this area of the movement es el Teatro Campesino. El Teatro Campesino es un grupo de guerrilleros. El Teatro Campesino es un arma contra aquellos que oprimen nuestra raza. El director del Teatro Campesino, Luis Valdés.
Year they got a short podium, you know. Last year the goddamn thing was up to here. Para por acá. No me gustan, you know, these things. But maybe it'll help to lean on it o algo, you know, recargarme. Esconderme cuando quiero rascar, you know, you can't see me. There are many things being said here today. Tal vez la cosa más agradable y más inspirante de lo que pasa ahora es que ninguna de las personas que están aquí ahora están diciendo cosas muy diferentes, ¿verdad?, a lo que está diciendo toda nuestra raza. We aren't saying anything that's particularly different. And that's good. We aren't saying anything that's particularly new. And that's good. So, I'm a little puzzled as to how to approach this whole bag, you know. Nombre está en el leaflet y todo el pedo, you know. And so, you gotta say some important things, they say, you know. Sometimes, my head, y mi mente, mi cabeza, mi alma, feels like a big red banner. And so I speak. Feel like speaking like a red banner, you know. Viva el comunismo y toda la chingada cosa, you know. Sometimes it feels like a flaming torch. Today it doesn't feel like that. Tijerina and Corky have handled that end of it, you know? My head today feels like a una cocina mexicana, you know? Full of tacos y enchiladas and things, you know? So I want to discuss some things, you know, about nuestra raza, la conciencia, el espíritu de nuestra gente, the more intimate life, you know, de nuestra raza, la vida cotidiana de nuestra gente, and how it relates to the revolutionary struggle. To take off from where Corky left off, a very important point about nacionalismo. It's a real thing. Tiene que ser real. For me, for the first time, in all of the years that we have been working to try to lift the raza, I felt a strain of nacionalismo and cultural militancy in Denver. Por primera vez. Because that was el grito that said, this time we're going completely out, totally out. And if it changes every one of our lives, no le hace, porque así debe de ser. But we're actually talking about, you say revolución y todo, you know, it's a fancy word. Lupe Saavedra mentioned he gets tired of hearing the word revolución in reference to the 1910 revolution. We're talking about today. A lot of vatos don't like it, you know. They don't like the thought of revolución. And you look around, los Estados Unidos está muy rico, you know. Hay muchos edificios, lots of carros y todo, you know, grandototes. You know, you wonder, what kind of revolución do we want? ¿Qué es la revolución que buscamos? You know, what is it that we really want? And what we really want is a sense of ourselves, todos, completos, desde la punta de la cabeza hasta las uñas, las pezuñas, ¿verdad? Tan cochinas, en la roña de las patas, you know, hasta abajo, you know. We want revolución, we want change. Tenemos que degabacharnos completamente. Become engabachados. Down to the most intimate parts of our nature. Hasta los últimos pelitos del culo, you know. Desgabacharnos. You know. Es difícil cuando está hablando uno la lengua de gabacho, ¿verdad? In English, we all realize this. I've seen our poetry is changing. We see it now in the periódicos, you know, and it's starting to come out, empieza a brotar, you know. And I know Alberto's going to talk next, you know, his poetry is an example of something breaking through. Because before we've been plastic, we've been covered with a nice plastic shell, you know. Y queremos ver la carne, queremos ver la sangre de nuestra alma. And the poetry is beginning to break through that fucking English, you know. A la lengua de nosotros, la lengua del pueblo, lo que somos, where are we going, you know. Who are we? We accomplish this through a writing. A poem that becomes a revolutionary poem that leads to revolutionary action. A fines de esa reacción revolucionaria hay sangre. That's right, there's sangre, there's blood, you know. Carne mutilada de mucha de nuestra gente, that's what it means. It's a game for keeps. We're talking about separatism. Separarnos estos pinches gabachos y establecer la dignidad completa de nuestro pueblo. So it becomes real. Ernie Gutierrez told me some time ago, one song Agustin Lira was in the teatro wrote, Que hubo raza, he says, that song has caused more divorces than anything else I know, you know. Que dice que el mexicano no va a hacerse gringo. And so we push with everything we've got, ¿ves? Ofrecemos todo lo que tenemos por la revolución, para esta revolución that must begin aquí, con los frijoles, aquí adentro en la panza. En el ombligo, eh? That's right, that's the way it is. Es como comer un plato de frijoles o papas con huevos, lo que sea, con mucho chile, ¿verdad? Nos enchilamos, ¿verdad?
Nos enchilamos hasta el fundido, pero nos gusta, mano. Nos gusta, you know? Está sudando el vato y dice, hijo, que a toda madre este, ¿vale? Que a toda madre este chile, you know? There's no kidding around with chile. No taco sauce ni nada de eso, ¿verdad? No ketchup, ¿verdad? We gotta push the ketchup aside, and the ketchup say, bueno, el ketchup está colorado, but it's not revolutionary, you know? El chile, you know? You gotta get into it. Ahí está, ¿verdad? And that's it. Y es lo que pasa. Es lo que está pasando. There's a revolution going on inside every one of us. De repente empiezan a qué? Explotar bigotes por todos lados, ¿verdad? When I was in college, I let this thing grow, ¿ves? There weren't too many. There weren't too many. This was 6, 7 years ago. There weren't too many of us, you know, and they era bandido, you know. But now, míralos, hijo, la. Boom, man. It's bursting out from all over the place, ¿verdad? My mother has a term still. Una vez mi papá se rasuró el bigote, ¿verdad? Dijo, no, déjate que se lo tienes tres caras de nalga. So no more caras en nalga, you know, everybody, you know. Vamos a dejar. No se escondan. Let it all hang out. That's right, just let it all grow. Que se salga. And that's the beginning. That's the beginning. We've lost so much de nuestra cultura. You take el calendario Azteca, ¿verdad? As it is today in Mexico, en el museo, colorless, made of stone, la piedra acabada, podrida. Y lo mira uno, ¿verdad? Y no puede ver los colores que en algún tiempo tenía esa piedra, porque los indios pintaban hasta las piedras. Lo pintaban con muchísimos colores, ¿verdad? Porque es lo que sentían ellos en sus corazones, esos colores. So you get the Aztec calendar stone, the way it's been recreated, and you see all the beautiful color in it, you know. Chihuahua, there it is, you know. Que a toda madre, you know. And many of our facets of our culture are like that piedra in the museum. Time has worn it off. Exploitation, the weather, we've lost our color. We got to recreate it so we get all those colores, you know. That beautiful thing that was there. Because los indios, you know, eran nobles. Tenían su cultura. Eran dignos y soberanos en algún tiempo, pero también fueron humanos, ¿verdad? También se echaban sus palitos de vez en cuando, you know. That's the truth. Perdone la palabra, estoy hablando de pleberías, ¿verdad? But if you chicks wanna, you know, become revolutionaries, tienen que aprender, you know. No more of this respect, you know, la delita, mano, las revolucionarias. Ellas hablaban sus chingadas madres, too, you know, everybody knew it. My mom, she does it, you know, and she's a madre like every madre, beautiful, you know, loves her children. Pero, you know, oye tú, cabrón, vente pa' acá, you know. That's what makes her beautiful. It's that. Y cuando, when, you know, it's down to the point, también se puede echar sus chingadas madres, you know. That's right, they know, you know. Our women fought in the revolution. ¿Por qué no? Mira, que la chingada, you know. Mi abuelita, the same way, you know. Anduvo sufriendo, pobrecita, you know. Durante toda la revolución, perdió dos esposos, ¿verdad? A fines se encontró con mi abuelito, ¿verdad? Yeah. Un viejo bigotón. Pero ella sabía de todo, ¿cómo no? Mira. That's us. Because that's who we are, raza. That's who we are. You look at Mexico, you know what Mexico has been. You look, there's been a division of classes and division of races there since the very beginning. Since the very beginning. We got to look at it and understand that. And sentidos humanos, ¿eh? Sentidos humanos. Antes había esa cultura india de los indios con toda su filosofía y la astronomía y todo. Y también con el pulque, con sus chiles, sus tamales, sus todo, ¿verdad? Lo tenían. All right. The white man came in, el español, el gachupa. Entró, ¿verdad? Y destruyó todo eso. Destroyed the image of our culture, our civilization then. Quetzalcoatl was real. Huitzilopochtli was real.
Tezcatlipoca was real. Tonatzin were real. Just like the Virgen de Guadalupe is real today. Así prieta y bonita que está. Así estaba la Tonatzin. Así, era real. These were beautiful things. Cada quien tenía su estatua, ¿verdad? Ahí está. No me tenten a mi huichilopochtli, ¿verdad? Porque pobrecito. Voy a prender una vela a mi huichilopochtli, ¿verdad? Voy a prender una vela a mi Quetzalcoatl. These things were real. They were part of us. Like frijoles. Like pulque, like tamales. That's how real the civilization was. The Spaniard came, y pácatelas, you know? No more, la cruz. That's another thing about revolucionario. You gotta look into your own soul. You're gonna lose your God. Van a perder su Dios. That's a fact. I'm sorry, you know? Jesucristo was the Judeo-Christian religion. Los Romanos brought it. Before Jesucristo, there was Tlaloc. Before Jesucristo, there were all these other gods. So if you're really revolucionarios, you're going to look into that. And you're going to look into the Catholic Church. Y van a decir, ¿de dónde viene esta institución? ¿De dónde viene esta iglesia? ¿De dónde viene tanto sacrificio que le damos a estos padres? ¿Verdad? ¿De dónde viene? And then you'll understand why. So many times in Mexico, los hombres, nuestra raza, nuestras mujeres, se han sangrado sobre esa batalla adentro de la iglesia, porque por demasiados años han habido aquellos hombres, sacerdotes, gordotes, ¿verdad?, que han explotado a la gente, le han chupado la sangre. Eso ha sido la iglesia en México, eso ha sido una institución de los españoles. Y no lo digo... No lo digo porque no soy hombre religioso, porque sí soy hombre religioso. Pero si tengo santos católicos, me queda solamente una, es la Virgen de Guadalupe. Y la quiero no porque representa a la Madre de Cristo, sino que porque representa a Tonantzin. Por eso, tenemos que restaurar nuestros dioses. They have to come back alive, raza. And when you sit down to pray, you pray to the big boys up there, porque todavía están allí, you know. They got a little confused también. They thought they were white for a while, you know. Los dioses, they got a little confused. But they're there. Quetzalcoatl is there. What greater God could we want than Quetzalcoatl? La serpiente emplumada. Bellísima. Ese Dios maravilloso que contiene todos los secretos de la vida. Todo lo más íntimo, ¿verdad? Ese fue el Dios que entró a la civilización de los aztecas y dijo, ya no más van a sacrificar almas humanas. Ahora van a ser civilizados. Si quieren sacrificar, van a sacrificar pedazos de roca, ¿verdad? Changos, víboras. Pero ningún hombre, no hay de qué tener miedo. Quetzalcoatl abraza todo de la vida. As a matter of fact, it's really key, it's really important, it's really central. We think about Quetzalcoatl. Too many of our people, for instance, they study, they learn, we try to recapture back what we are, but we become intellectual. Nos hacemos intelectuales. Y perdemos aquello que teníamos, ¿verdad? Cuando jugábamos canicas, ¿verdad? Perdemos todo eso que teníamos antes. Okay, you can hold on to that. Oh, the American educational system, actually the whole European, white, Western European culture, you know, is not ours and it's full of shit, man. Forget it, you know. They made their little divisions and they lost, you know. They're destroying themselves today. They're doing this. Están destruyendo los babosos, you know. They're killing themselves. That's right. The Indio has survived. Okay, but what does that mean? They got life, la vida. Like we're all born into the vida. En pelotos, ¿verdad? With slime all over us, llorando. You know, así, ¿verdad? Llorando, ¿eh? Quiero una chichi, you know? That's the way everybody's born, you know? But then they go into a society and white Western European culture tells them, this is life. Life is divided up into politics, into economics, into astronomy, into literature, into this, into that, ¿verdad? And if you can't understand that, then you're lower class and you're good and you're dirty and get out, you don't know. Pero los indios didn't divide it up that way. Teníamos sabios, We had geniuses. We had a complete civilization. Yes? We didn't divide it up that way. We didn't necessarily divide the humanities and the sciences. And this is what's at the bottom, at the heart, el corazón, in the struggle, la lucha en las escuelas ahora, because we know that this goddamn system that they got is no good. It's stupid. Le falta algo. Le falta sal, you know? We want the right. We want the right to be able to discuss Kant, ¿verdad? Kant, lo que sea, ¿verdad? Any of these philosophers. Y al mismo tiempo echarnos un pedo si nos da la gana, you know? Somebody says, well, that's not right. ¿Y por qué no? Mira. It's a natural function, you know? We'll invent an air conditioning system to take care of that. No, but people tienen tripas, raza. Who knows this better than we, la raza, nosotros, la plebe con pleberías? Sure, we came from Mexico. You know, sure, we got mariachis. But what do mariachis represent con sus sombrerotes en dorado, verdad? Decorados. They represent the rich, los que nos estaban chingando. That's what the mariachi represents. Nosotros, the raza that we came from, wore sombreros y calzones blancos y guarachis, verdad? Esos, de esos mexicanos, venimos nosotros. De ahí. Y nuestras mujeres con sus rebozos haciendo tortillas, ¿eh? De esa gente, la plebe, de ahí vinimos, de ahí somos. No vinimos para acá porque nuestra gente se estaba muriendo de hambre allá. No vinimos para acá porque allá nos mataron nuestros líderes. Nos mataron nuestro Pancho Villa, nos mataron nuestro Emiliano Zapata. Allá no, allá hubo opresión y nuestros padres o abuelos se vinieron para acá en busca de una vida mejor, ¿verdad? Y luego miramos todo de la riqueza que había aquí, o decían que era riqueza, ¿verdad? Los edificios, el dinero y todo. Y dijimos, chihuahua, man, I want some of that, you know? That's pretty good, you know? I want a car y todo. Sin contestar el valor básico de esas cosas. What the hell is a car good for, man, you know? We can work up another system, you know? Let everybody smoke a little toluachi and you'll get there by yourself, man. That's right, you know. And so, that isn't our Mexico, the Mexico del ranchero, you know, y el jinete en el sombrero. Part of it is, the working man, el jinete, that was us, you know. Pero no el ranchero, no el hacendado, no el mariachi. Mariachi isn't all that old anyway. It comes from a French word, and the French were only there a century ago. So mariachi isn't very old. Lo más mexicano is embodied in the thought of Quetzalcoatl. The thought that you can be really religious, intellectual, that you can understand what the fuck this life is all about, but at the same time, sentarte con un plato de frijoles y gozar, 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 y echarte un trago de pulque y dices, ¡y que a toda madre! ¿Verdad? That's the Indian belief. Ahí está lo indio. And this is where America cuts into us because it says, be intellectual. Discuss the problems of the Mexican-American. They give us the terms, the terminology, sociological terms. This is the way we look at the goddamn thing. We look at our barrios, we talk about upward mobility. Fuck upward mobility, man. ¿Quién lo quiere? Who wants it, man? It's not upward mobility, you know. That's not what it's all about. Y lo digo, you know, I'm rattling off here. Maybe some of you women, you know, pobrecitas, you know, are insulted, you know, I'm sorry. You know, maybe some of you like to hear this, Jay. Cochinas. Les gusta. But you know, I'm coming on straight here, you know. I'm coming on straight. I got a college education, pero no me quito la roña, you know. I still got it, man, you know. I was born a campesino and I'm gonna die a campesino. Y es todo, mano, you know. And so that's why we do teatro, ¿ves? One more thought about Quetzalcoatl. One more thought. We should get to the symposium, ¿verdad? Debemos sentarnos a hablar, ¿verdad? Los heavies. Quetzalcoatl also was recognized as Eecatl. Eecatl, el dios de los vientos. I couldn't understand why. ¿Cómo que el dios de los vientos? You know, why the dios de los vientos? Until it hit me not too long ago. Too long ago. El dios de los vientos. Think about el viento. La vida, ¿verdad?
El mexicano dice, la vida no vale nada. Y tal vez porque no le ha valido mucho, ¿verdad? It hasn't been worth very much. Pero también there's something else there that goes back to the Indio again. The Indio believed que él era la tierra y la tierra era él. Que él era el árbol y el árbol era él. Y daba su vida y su corazón para que siguiera la civilización. Life, man, was nothing, you know. Yo soy apenas una expresión, una gota de mi pueblo. Yo soy apenas una gota de sangre, ¿verdad? Si yo muero, mi pueblo sigue viviendo. La inmortalidad de todos nosotros está en nuestro pueblo. Ahí está. And if you believe in reincarnation, shit, you can be born again, ¿ves? That's right. As soon as we lose that Judeo-Christian religion, you begin to get into some heavy stuff, man. You begin to wonder, you know. Puedes nacer otra vez. How do you know, man, you can't be born again? How do you know, eh? How do you know? Those Indians, India, they believe it. And they eat frijoles and tortillas. They don't call it that, but they eat frijoles and tortillas. And Chile. That's right. How do you know? You know, as the white man told you, vatos, you know, you only live once. They told you, you're going up to heaven or you're going down to hell. Screw that shit, man. We can be born again. 5 or 6 or 7 times, ¿ves? Or 8 or 32 times, si quieres, ¿verdad? That's right. Si te truenan en esta, pues, next time, you know. So that's what I mean about that saying, la vida no vale nada. There's a lot in that, man. You know, who is it that says, la vida's worth something? You know, the gabacho says, man, we can't do this. We can't go around and risk too much. We got to be careful. We shouldn't take these risks. Everything's got to be prepared, you know. Dicen los Boy Scouts, you know. You know, be prepared. In other words, don't live. Don't live. If you have $5, don't blow it on beer with your friends, man. Save it, you know. Eh? That's right. So it's a whole approach to life, you know. And then out of that grows a thought, I want to control you. Aha, I got the goods on you. The CIA is taking notes. They're going to steal these tapes the way they did at Denver, you know. We got the word, man. We know what you said. Well, fuck you, man. I don't care, you know. What can they do to us? What can they do to us? ¿Qué no van a hacer? Chop us up, make enchiladas out of us, you know? Molernos. They kill us, nel, nunca nos van a matar. They die, we don't. Nosotros no nos moriremos. And so there you have Ehecatl. Ehecatl, Quetzalcoatl, el dios del viento, because what can you do to the viento? You can't do anything to the viento, mano. You can't punch it. You can't cut it up. You can't shoot it. You can't lock it up. You can't do anything to the viento. Nosotros somos el viento. That's right, and we can be a storm, or it can be a mild breeze. Pero somos el viento, y nunca nos van a conquistar. Nunca. We're here forever. Nuestra raza ha renacido para siempre. That's what it means, Quetzalcoatl. Los frijoles y la religión. Mano en mano, eh. ¡Ay! ¿Listos? ¿Listos? Ok. Si quieren gritos, si quieren gritos, a few Chicano powers. You know how it goes, eh? I say Chicano, you say power. ¿Listos? ¡Chicano! 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 ¡Viva la raza!
¡Viva la raza!
Thank you. Un anuncio sobre la causa del campesino. It needs constant help, you know. We have too many weekend revolutionaries, you know. Nos gusta el pedo, you know. Las banderas and the chicks, it's all very beautiful. Pero también se necesita sudor. And the picket line. And
Los campesinos need your help. They need Chicano faces, man. Es una vergüenza, mano, que hay más gabachos en those picket lines than raza. Es una vergüenza, mano, it really is. We can take care of ourselves, mano. Si nos vamos a separar, who's gonna walk the picket lines for us? Nosotros. Nosotros. Every one of us, man, has to get out there. Every one of us. That's what it means. De eso se trata la causa. So tomorrow is International Boycott Day. Eh? Picket lines all over the city, man. You can contact UMAS chapter here. They'll tell you where, you know. So be out there, raza, you know. Una poca de conciencia, eh. ¡Viva el campesino! ¡Viva la raza!
¡Viva!
All right, the farm workers are also passing around for donations, you know, like give. Por las calles de nuestros barrios pasan nuestros dioses antiguos llamando a nuestro pueblo, al pueblo que a veces ha olvidado sus raíces y sus antiguos dioses. Los dioses antiguos, los dioses de los mexicanos han tomado forma en el espíritu del movimiento. Y han dado voz a nuestros poetas que nos llaman a la belleza y a la lucha. Poeta de su pueblo, alurista de San Diego.
¡Que viva la raza! ¡Que viva la raza! ¡Que viva la revolución!
¡Viva!
¡Y que vivan nuestros dioses!
¡Viva! To begin with, I'm going to read a little poem about a man that many of us know very well. Some of us call him the Chango, some of us call him the Perros, the Pig. Y el poema se llama Marrana Flaca.
Revolution rape to mutate pigs in the exasperated pangs of empty stomachs. Kill for love of an angered freedom late to come. Kill in yourself the oxide of your pestilent fear. Assassination crawl to pigs and those running naked and afraid. Mutant supper of aromatic exposure to the sun like it is. Tell yourself no lies, but sour truths. And sulfur boil for blood have for your nectar. Mañana the thirst of drought and lacerated solitude may swim along with you in death wish waterfalls. Today, in the desperation of your cry, sore throat, arid dreams can find oasis with nopales wet. Brother, be born to the cavern, to the obscurity, to the black dark stench. Brother, be born. After your suicide, mutation, birth to quench, to the cavern spring a river crystal bath to cleanse a pig, to rape a fear, to strip a lie and tell it like it is. In the desert of your sweat, the wetness of a tear, add a bit of salsa, warm your plate, and of bones rid off in la libertad alada, fly with anchored heart to kiss an earthworm in his plight. Brother, be born in lungful suck of dew, on fertile ground plow freedom. In the volition of your flesh, eat the frijoles of the palm trees in your island green. Partake of your bread, raza bronce, raza black, yellow, white, raza red, eat together. Let the stare of pig grow blank. bland isolation he has reaped to die, alone, perhaps. The evolution of our libertad has cried, ya basta! To restore el pan de cada día, the pig will have to join our Cosa Linda to feed Jorge, Margarita, who hunger libertad. The majority of the poetry that we're going to hear today is mad because there are very few happy things that we can really sit down and talk about aside from the love that we can address to our brothers and sisters, to our carnales, carnalas, jefas, jefes, niños y niñas. The next poem, unexpectedly my night gloom came. Unexpectedly my night gloom came in justa capa fúnebre. I realized devoured me, y mis tripas gnawed la luna y su eclipse, the cultural assassination of my people, de mis abuelos, y corrí hacia el sol, el de mis padres. The one that printed on my zarape fantastic colors through the prism, la pirámide del sol, at the sacrificial teocatl, my fathers wore their plumage to listen, ensoplaron vida con sus solares rayos en mi raza. Let's try to keep this thing. Why don't we, you know, run through and keep the Simón. Después los aplausos, ¿no? Vamos a ver si nos podemos adquirir un estado de conciencia, un estado espiritual, un estado emocional, donde podamos descubrir la sangre que corre por nuestras venas, de manera que vamos a guardar los aplausos para después, por favor. Most of us have heard about La Llorona. La Llorona, que tiene muchas formas, que sale en las calles, la placa, chillando con sus sirenas. Las mujeres que pierden a sus niños, que pierden a sus hombres. La mayoría de nosotros reconocen esta imagen. Must be the season of the witch, la bruja, la llorona. She lost her children and she cries. En las barrancas of industry, her children. Devoured by computers and the gears. Must be the season of the witch. I hear huesos crack en pain y lloros. La bruja pangs. Sus hijos han olvidado la magia de Durango y la de Moctezuma el Huiclamina. Must be the season of the witch. La bruja llora. Sus hijos sufren sin ella. Clamping las almas de un pueblo, de nuestra gente que vibra, cuya cola cascabel cascabelea, rattle, rattle coil, let the clamored hope to breathe, breathe. In the thorax of Aztlán, de soplo de Dios Quetzal, culebra tierra de barro, tear the brazos off the máquina, off with this chingada head, let the tuercas gorge and splatter, for el corazón is mourning, where spades are called machetes, donde las armas son cohetes. Ruido, verdad y guitarras. Let the last alambre burn and breath be rattled. Lengua, garganta, callecida. Lengua, garganta, callecida en seco ardor, in the fire picazón that boils a breath. La carne de los labios brama, de palabras da mutiny a tongue, crave to be spilt in llamas, to splatter paredes arrugadas upon which silence falls, in the rooftops of tongues crawl in flight to the cuevas, in prayers de rodillas laceradas, pesadillas y recuerdos fried in chile, gritan, our tongues gritan el derecho, gritan justicia, and the forked ones encadenan, en azúcares drogadas, twist our culture y envenenan, en the fire picazón, boils en alientos, rapes melcocha mouths, to feed them lava, burning con chile, la lengua, and the lies del arrastrado. The man is always rapping about how much noise we're always making when we're quiet all the time, calladito, sin hablar, sin decir nada, nos calla. Pos hablar, hacer ruido, vidrios rotos, lumbres calles, gasolina en llamas, en banquetas, fired up, con mariachis, sentados en el suelo, serenata, reliving sueños, buñuelos y piñatas de papel, feria en firecrackers, cracking skulls no more but running, bailando en las calles, descalzos al sol ardiente, ashamed, sin calzones. The man say we making noise. Hacer ruido pues, mariachi, orquesta, corrido, mucho ruido, mucha fiesta, when we quiet all the time. This is a poem that I address to the draft in the system that sends our people to fight for something that is a non-existent entity, for the rights of la raza. Los nopales con espinas carnes, rifle en mano, guerra, tripas fuera. Manuel drifted down the drain, drowned, druggy dentro to the station sergeant bellyman, he volunteered. He volunteered a matar, rifle en mano, guerra, carne muerta, suerte, por sus manos, muerte. Inocentes dedos firma, nothing doing at the station killed the animals. Mud and jungle boots of leather kill now, kill, kill, kill. Por la patria, la bandera, tu terruño, tu sudor on welfare cutthroat laws, but kill for cigarettes of cancer pack. Pork and beans and chili con carne. Chocolate to the little children give instead of father's dead. Chocolate sin leche, sin atole. Con medallas de papel en pecho pinned to hunt. Savage kill the animals climb on threesome jungle metaphors. Make fall to flee, to fly away, to run, to die, to death. And find a near-cut trophy, proof of manhood dreams and toys to play. Manuel, Chicano, not you, to war, to kill, yourself at his command, mediocre coin, papá se mata solo en la cosecha, ante el sol, en el lodo de la siembra, Juan, tu carnal en la fábrica, ante el foco, en el vacío de la máquina, Manuel, he gonna kill, he gonna crush, he gonna train at home, here in the barrio, high 10 miles on the street. Basin headman hassle sticks no more. Snipers, threesome, windows, Molotovs. Molotovs and bottled gasoline throws. To weep the blood, our forefathers, dad and I seen him sweating whipped for pennies off his Clorox hand. The man, cream serpent, slippery thing. Vile tongue, kill Indians, kill blacks, kill colored, he white cosa. He Anglo, kill Chicano. Cut the gibberish out, he say one day, I say, I will no more to you listen who to say, have nothing, empty belly station kill, no more for you, now for mi raza, por mi pueblo, por mi sangre roja piel. Si he de morir, Manuel, contigo, contra el que oprime, los dos, together, here, lucharemos. This poem, the one I'm going to read now, was actually inspired by a pingo. A vato who was always on blancas y la fregada, running up and down and here and there. And he was always talking to us about death riding on a soda cracker. Death riding on a soda cracker, hassling badges and clubs at hand to crack skulls, to crack walls, to crack death on adobe halls. Man, don't know the soda cracking dead. He don't know the hassle of his batch, the clubbing kill, or he don't know what's living. He don't know, no sabe nada, absolutamente nada. Vacío su pecho de emociones, rosas rojas, verdes realidades, no sabe nada. The man, he cannot see, carnales, carnales de pedernal. En la paja de este mundo, una chispa prende al fuego. Light up, brother Brown, chicano vato, enciéndase solo, carnal, y encienda, encienda la paja. Donde comal, get your tortillas going. Feed your children con frijoles, con la sangre de tu fuego. A los niños, a tus hijos alimenta. Tráeles a tu mundo nuevo, al mundo de raza fuego, donde chicanos descubren realidades en verdades de ternura. La revolución desnuda in the up and throes of platitudes, of reactionary attitudes, of apathy avergonzada, riding on a soda cracker, blindness and helmeted skull, sucia muerte, negro y blanco, colorblind, so colorblind the man is color brown blind, color culture blind, se ha olvidado de su vida, to remember gold coin God, le ha prendido veladoras a su Dios, Dios moneda, plata y pisoteante. Blow up tight to fly in the nubes of our joy. Raza, never die. Mujer eterna, raza, raza nueva, raza, raza. En desarapes find the truth. En los colores contrastes de tu piel. Raza roja, raza black. Yellow raza, raza piel del bronce. Uptight. Today in the swamps of pestilence, heavy dreams on our shoulders, an open carretera to follow. Libres, al fin, raza libre, raza nace, raza bronce, fly, and uptight, blow. Because la raza is tired, I find time in molasses thick. We cannot wait because la raza is tired, we cannot wait. The brown-eyed sun is out to shine a crystal dream, to walk an autumn leaf, to earthy drought, to bring water in cubetas, put our fire of red uniform, arriving to feed on ashes, en las ruinas, calaveras, rocas, tristes recuerdos vacíos of a dead people. Genocide, genocide. We cannot wait for suicide because la raza is tired. We cannot wait because wait because la raza, tired, torn, while la raza is being born. Taza de barro en la que bebo mi café. Humo pendiente de mis labios se evapora. There is time still in the waterfalls of anger. Chicanos en el barrio, esperanza en cancerosa célula. En el capitalismo radica la moneda. En el socialismo viven los hombres. Viven como hombres entre hombres, no como zombies, cuerpos entre robots tragamonedas. Carga pistola y mace, helmeted skulls to serve you unto death. In capitalism there is a choice. We can die poisoned by decrepit social political institutions. We can die slowly, or we can die quickly, massacred in our cry for justice. You know, today we've been talking about a lot of things that have to arrive at the core of our spirit, at the center of our heart. We have to start pounding, we have to start beating, we have to start eating frijoles y salsa. We have to start using huaraches y botas. We have to start thinking and living Chicano. You know, a lot of things, I think, have been pointed out today. And I would like to, at this point, before I go on, to clarify some of the things that we very openly have to confront, fight, and literally destroy. There is a certain amount of destruction
that has to take place in this society because it's sick. And there's a certain amount of construction that has to take place in our society because we have never been allowed to do so. This country is based on three things: suppression, repression, and oppression. Simply, we have to replace these things with creation, expression, and liberation. This country is based on competition, private enterprise, profit motive, and elitism. We have to replace these principles with cooperation, public enterprise, human satisfaction, and participation. And in order to do these things, we have to take three steps. And we are just beginning to come to the first one, and we have been really deceived into believing that we are in the second one. We have to begin to fraternize. We have to love our brothers. We have to see in every Chicano, on every bean, on every forehead, un carnal, una carnala, una madre, un padre, un hijo, una hija. We have to fraternize. Then, and only then, can we talk about organizing. We've been talking about organizing for a long time, and the degree and the level of organizing that we have been carrying on is the degree and the level that the Anglo has taught us, where we put up all sorts of offices up there, the president, the secretary, the vice president, la fregada, and then we put men and women to fill these offices. Charlie, that's not the way we are. That's not the way we, if we discover ourselves, really are. Each one of us is very individualistic. You know, each one of us is a person. We have to develop ourselves as individuals first, and then we can see that there are those places that we can fill, that there are those roles that we can play. But we cannot walk into an office and say, just because I'm the president, just because I've been elected vice president, secretary, y la fregada ya estuvo. No, ni madres, así no va a salir nada. We have to discover in ourselves those things which we are capable of doing first, and then we can move into positions which will allow us, first of all, to be satisfied as human beings, and second of all, to work together with our people. The second step then is organize. And the third step has been clarified and talked about over and over today, and that is nationalize. Nationalize. There is a marcha down in San Diego tomorrow. Una marcha like San Diego has never had. I don't know if there have been marchas similar to the one that has been planned down there. And this marcha is to celebrate one thing that many of us have forgotten. We have picked a symbol, la madre. ¿Por qué la madre? Because the only structure that keeps us alive and will allow us to survive and to liberate ourselves is the family. Y la madre es aquella persona la cual no solamente proporciona los fundamentos de cualquier individuo, los fundamentos que caracterizan nuestra personalidad y nuestro intelectualismo, nuestro emocionalismo, etc. La madre. Vamos a festejar esto mañana, vamos a partir de una iglesia y vamos a ir a lo que se llama Civic Center o Concourse, I don't know qué fregado se llama. Y por lo tanto, todas las personas que atienden ahorita a esta conferencia están invitadas. Va a tomar lugar de las 11 de la mañana hasta quién sabe cuándo. El pedo va a estar sabroso y a los que les guste el pedo, pues vamos para allá. Bendito sea tu vientre, madre, virgin of love, sin condiciones, you've chiseled me well. El lustre de mi bronce a ti lo debo, y a la herencia of our caciques, we owe nuestro calor, and the candor of our joy. Our madres taught us to germinate, in the passion of our lives, bendita seas, en mi raza. We have been talking about other things today. We have been talking about
our campesino brothers, nuestros carnales, que los gringos son los que van a los picket lines y la fregada, you know. I think it's a well-taken thing to start thinking in terms of, not that we want to let the gabacho out, but the point is that the gabacho is doing the work for us, and if we allow that to happen, you know, it's the same pedo all over again. The man is in control. Dusk, double doors, mis labradores. Dirty cadenas of odio chained to the sweatshops, the sweat fields and prisons, outhouse omens, up in dawns of cold rushing, rising in Calvary thorns, freezing the spines of our pueblo. Nunca, mi moreno pueblo, never, nunca, in our barrio occupations not allowed. Let the barrio be a barrio, barrio, barrio and not blood-sweating colonia, planting cactus flower pots, regando el jardín de plumas. Salute the sun in ayunas, mis labradores, carnales. Tear, tear down the outhouse cadenas. Open las puertas de Aztlán, fuera del fil y las espinas, a proteger nuestras flores. El poema que sigue es un poema que habla de la sangre, que habla de la nación, que habla de Quetzalcóatl, que habla de la vida y que habla de la muerte. On the history of our wounds, the epitaph of our hearts pounds. Tu cuerpo de carne, bronce, sangre, toca puertas, toca mi alma. El espíritu cascabeleando vuela, vibra muerte a través de un evil eye o una aguja marker en la carne, of a tierra arrebatada where the lapida of my flesh shall caress the stolen land and kiss the rocas, a mother. India muerta en plumas y en cananas, junto a mi tumba, mi madre. Our sangre, la resurrección morena. Our sangre, la resurrección de bronce. I'm going to read two last poems. And both of these poems were written under the influence of Denver, Colorado, and the happenings over there, cuando decidimos que se vale todo nuestra casa. Cohetes de malinches lenguas, preoccupied statues, piedras entumidas sin calor y sin amor moreno. El carnalismo nace como la tuna, entre espinas de dulzura. El color zarape de contrastes y la marcha mestiza, sentimientos que flotan en el aire, la bandera. Chicanos praying to the sun, marchando en la misa. Power to las manos que trabajan. Power to all who dig on tortillas y que se bañan en sudor salado, trabajando en penitencia, haciendo liberación. Piernas waking to the marcha of our pueblo, our gente en los barrios, en las escuelas, en las canerías, en la pizca, en las calles. Our steps are measured. ¡Chale! We can't take no measurement. ¡Chale! No more rezos de rodillas. No more apologies for ser de carne y de hueso. Porque tenemos hambre and our children are singing con orgullo. Los niños are just beginning to be hombres. Los hombres ya espinados are hungry, hungry for tunas, for dulzura, por amor de carnales. Nuestra casa es nuestra casa. Tenemos que lavar platos, tenemos que barrer de chingaderas left by the jurado en las cadenas of oppression. Tenemos que construir de adobe corazón a casa calor de fuego libertad. Nuestra casa es nuestra casa. And the tunas of our struggle are eaten in nuestra casa. Fuera muebles coloniales, we're gonna sleep with zarapes to dream our sueños de fuego, to wake el espíritu que vibra en la sangre que nuestra raza ya llora, ya clama justicia. De dos caras we've been born, nuestra madre, mujer india, nuestro padre, el europeo. Nuestro corazón mestizo has now grown bigotes, brochas y hasta pelos. con el frijol en la frente, with cheekbones al frente, facing al sol encuerado, drilling freedom in the clouds, la bandera mexicana, kiss the heights. Y entre gritos, el espíritu moreno, thrusting flechas en de estatuas, tongues once fork are silent, quiet ante la verdad morena, that our sons have calentado, casa, raza, 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 carnal, bronce, ríe, canta, risking your life for la causa, living for revolución, que yace ya en nuestra casa. And the last poem is a version of the words once spoken by Zapata that led Zapata and the Zapatistas to a revolution that involved a lot of killing, a lot of deaths, and a lot of injustices. Las Cananas y el Calvario, dos hermanos en su muerte, bullet seven shot and planted, tear, tear, bullet, que yo te veo en mi machete. Ignored, you will find yourself, Calvario, penitencia, te desea mi flagelado cuerpo. Parado en mi corazón, rock of solitude, now burning, my penitence de rodillas nunca encontrará mi muerte. El carnaval de dolor y las máscaras de Cristo, brutalized facades in hiding, all masks be fallen, be flown. Al rugido de una flecha, las cananas en mi barrio, la liberación Calvario, mejor muerto y bien parado than beg living de rodillas.
Luis Arroyo, chairman of UMAS UCLA.
For once I feel warmth here in this university. For once I feel good in this university. For once there are people here que tienen alma, que sienten, que saben que está malo con la raza. And now that you people are here, I can see now why we spend our time trying to bring students into this university. Why after so many goddamn frustrating days of trying to recruit people, fighting with this administration, fighting with the Gabacho, bringing in that raza. I know it's worthwhile, because you can see the spirit here. And what I'd like to do at this time is I want to name off some of the organizations which are present here. If I leave out your organization, it's only through my ignorance, so bear with me. Con nosotros tenemos Lucha, La Raza, Roosevelt UMAS, the Berets, BBSO, Cathedral, Oxnard Brown Berets, MAPA, La Junta, Trade Tech, Proyecto del Barrio, LA Valley College UMAS, the Teatro Chicano, Garfield UMAS, Cruzada de Colorado, Bala, the West Side, East LA Welfare Rights, La Verdad, Maya de San Diego, La Vida Nueva. But now I want to talk about a problem which we encounter in the barrios every day. This is called Gabacho justice. Today, John Marquez, Shorty de la Junta, went before a Gabacho judge, Judge Marion. The charge, drunk driving. The case before Shorty's involved a man, a Chicano, who took a cuete into a baby shower, threatened the kids there, the wife, and the judge let the man go. When Shorty faced the judge decided, looking over the record, that there was only one thing to do to Shorty, which was to send him to jail. Why? Because when Shorty was arrested, he had made the mistake of calling the cops racist pigs. So what the judge told Shorty was, after looking over your record and seeing what you call these people, you're probably gonna add me to your list. So therefore, I sentence you to 6 months in jail plus a $500 fine. This is for drunk driving. If any of you have ever been arrested on such a charge, you know how steep this is. Also, Shorty is suspended. Till this fine is paid, Shorty will spend extra time in jail. So that means that if the fine isn't paid for till the end of the 6 months, he gets another 6 months in jail. So when you people leave here, I would appreciate it at the door. There'll be people taking up a collection. La Junta will be taking a collection at the door. Come across and reach in deep. Please. Viva la raza ese. Now. We are separate, hermano. Ya sabes. I just want to take this opportunity on the part of UCLA UMAS to thank all of you for being here, for showing up. One. Two, three.
La esperanza de nuestra raza somos nosotros mismos. El tiempo de la humillación ha pasado. Que el movimiento sea como una espada por la liberación de su pueblo. Que el movimiento sea como la onda de David, que traiga abajo el gigante, como empezamos el plan de Aztlán. En el espíritu de una raza que ha reconocido no solo su orgullosa herencia histórica, sino también la bruta invasión gringa de nuestros territorios, nosotros los chicanos, habitantes y civilizadores de la tierra norteña de Aztlán, de donde provenieron nuestros abuelos, solo para regresar a sus raíces y consagrar la determinación de nuestro pueblo del sol, declaramos que el grito de la sangre es nuestra fuerza, nuestra responsabilidad y nuestro inevitable destino. Somos libres y soberanos para señalar aquellas tareas por las cuales gritan justamente nuestra casa, nuestra tierra, el sudor de nuestra frente y nuestro corazón. Aztlán pertenece a los que siembran la semilla, riegan los campos y levantan la cosecha, y no al extranjero europeo. No reconocemos fronteras caprichosas en el continente de bronce. El carnalismo nos une y el amor hacia nuestros hermanos nos hace un pueblo ascendiente que lucha contra el extranjero gabacho, que explota nuestras riquezas y destroza nuestra cultura. Con el corazón en la mano y las manos en la tierra, declaramos el espíritu independiente de nuestra nación mestiza. Somos la raza de bronce con una cultura de bronce. Ante todo el mundo, ante Norteamérica, ante todos nuestros hermanos en el continente de bronce, somos una nación, somos una unión de pueblos libres, somos Aztlán. Por la raza, todo, fuera de la raza, nada, venceremos. Órale, you know, los carnales que, you know, want to speak up, rap with the people up here in front or rap with each other, we'll have a period of about half an hour, y luego nos vamos a the third floor Kirchhoff Hall. Everyone is invited to get together up on the third floor Kirchhoff Hall, right here after this mitote. Órale, ¿quién es el primero? You know, statements, preguntas, lo que sea. Órale, Ramsés. Yeah. Están micrófonos aquí en el lado. There are mics here on the side. You want to say something, just get up there.
Bueno, bueno.
Órale.
Quisiera hacerle una pregunta a la persona ahí en la mesa, cualquier persona que quiera contestar esto sobre las clases de personas que necesitamos para este movimiento. Sí necesitamos vatos locos, necesitamos gentes que sean líderes políticos, y me gustaría oír de alguna persona en la mesa de qué clase de personas necesitamos en este movimiento.
Necesitamos todas clases de gente, de todos lados, del barrio, del campo, de los colegios, de las escuelas, de las pintas, de todos lugares. We have to understand that if we are talking about being one, we have to have people who are committed to being part of la raza. We have to listen to our poets, listen to those words that say, we are one. Maybe we can't get along one person with the other, because some guys sleep with their wife and fight with her in the morning, but they get along. They believe in the same things, their children and their family. And la raza is a family. And everybody has to take part. If the barrio is to be taken over and controlled economically, politically, and socially, the only way to do it is by having everybody take part in helping. If the great boycott is to be successful to help the campesino, then every Mexicano must be committed to be a campesino and make sure that you get rid of the grapes. You want to do it your way, or do it our way, like putting watermelons on top of grapes and canned goods, or pinching them, or hijacking trucks, a brother said. You know, but the boycott must be successful, or the campesino is going to lose this battle, and he can't afford to lose it. So we are all campesinos. We are all college students when you demonstrate. The older people should come out and hit the front line and be willing to go to jail, be willing to be attacked, be willing to be clubbed, be willing to be maced, and to be with the young people down in the high schools. To be willing to be with the little niños when they go to juvenile hall. Because when you turn the young barrio vato into a revolutionary instead of a juvenile delinquent, they're going to close those reform schools. They won't want any more of us kind of revolutionaries in there. And we're going to have to liberate what we consider political prisoners, and that's everybody that hasn't received a fair trial and has gone before a court of racist white pigs, jury, judge, that sentenced Shorty,
They can release another man, and we all know the comparisons, and we all know that the gringo is now trying to legalize pot because Sonny Boy is smoking it in all the colleges, and maybe daddy's smoking it too. But what are they going to do about the 7 to 5 and 5 to 7 they gave all the Mexicanos? How are they going to reimburse us for that? It's like saying, how are they going to reimburse all our madrecitas, the jefitas, and all the old people who suffered because they ate meat on Friday, and now it's all right to eat meat on Friday? How are we going to do this when they change laws, when they change laws to suit themselves? That's why we have to take control. And those are the kind of people we need. We need the kind of people that are, have no fear. And we teach fear. When you're not afraid that you're being called a bad show for demonstrating, you lose one fear. When you're not afraid to lose a job because you demonstrate or because you stand up for your raza, you get rid of another fear. When you're not afraid to lose your house or your car, that's another fear you get rid of. When you're not afraid to be split open and see your own blood and feel some pain, and it goes away, just takes time. When you're not afraid to breathe mace and gas, because you can get rid of that with a little time. And when you're not afraid to die, then there's nothing that this man can take away from you. There's nothing he can deal with you on no level, because he's afraid to lose his car, to lose his home, to lose his clothes, to lose his wife. And he's losing a whole lot of them, man. And he's afraid to lose his money or his blood. And we don't have any money, but we've got a lot of blood. And we know one thing, when we're not afraid to lose that, how can he deal with us? When we can think collectively like that, then what's he gonna do? He's gonna run, or he's gonna say, man, you better take it over. And we're gonna take it over. And that's the difference. We need all types. We need everybody. We need women and children and men, real women and men. One other thing I'd add, leadership is many things. Leadership is someone who gets up and speaks an idea. Leadership is poetry that inspires a man to be willing to die. Leadership is a teacher that teaches people or is willing to take a position to give a real education to their people. Leadership is a historian who writes the history and speaks it. Leadership is a teatro that gives you an idea. Leadership can be an economist who comes into a barrio to show you how to get rid of the exploiter and the pigs, and how to control, how to develop our own resources, how to bring us together to share our own money, or not money, but buying power. You know, leadership can come in many forms. Leadership can be the barrio vato who's the security. Leadership can be a demolition expert. Leadership is part of la raza on any level.
Yeah, let me... ¿Está jalando? ¿Jala? No jala. The example, el ejemplo de la cruzada por la justicia, the crusade for justice, I think is above all an answer to the question. There you have an organization that is precisely what Alberto was talking about, based on the unit of the family, the familia. You see, mothers and daughters, along with their fathers and brothers, organizando uniéndose, peleando por sus derechos, y sobre todo los niños. Little kids, man, you know. You guys, you vatos, you know, carnales, were at the Denver conference, saw those little kids come out with their poetry, 4, 5, 6 years old, you know. That's power. That's force for the future. So there's no limit, you know, to the number of people that can be involved. Everybody has to be involved. If one man goes into the movement, he cannot expect to fight with his wife over whether he's going to lose his job because of what he's doing. He's got to win his wife over, you know? And so if the movement means that the family is going to suffer a little bit, we really can't suffer all that much, not any more than we have already. Así es que los hijos, las madres, esposas, esposos, hermanos, todos, they all have to come together. And it's the responsibility of every Chicano to organize his own familia first. Work on your own carnales, you know, within your own family, right there. That's where the movement starts. Ahí está.
You know, Dad, one other thing. I read a beautiful story in El Grito about the Yaqui Indians who were trapped by the Españoles. El comandante de los Españoles says, kill every man, kill every woman, and kill every child, because in each one of them, in the stomach of the woman, in the heart of the child, there's a guerrero. And you've now heard the story and the slogan that's coming out of Mexico, and the students. Ya murió el jefe Zapata, pero ahora todos somos zapatistas.
Just a short question.
Yeah. We're going to have to cut this in a while. Again, va a haber refrescos y pan de dulce y todo. Y allá en el tercer piso de Kirchhoff Hall, que está aquí enseguida, we'll be able to piroquear con más confianza y todo acá entre nosotros. So we're going to cut it short. Solo unas preguntas más ya. Pero todavía no se acaba el mitote. Sigue después. Órale.
Aunque estamos hablando aquí de separatismo y estamos hablando de conservar la identidad y la cultura del mexicano, quisiera preguntarle al señor Alberto Urista, al carnal, que si me va a decir que en la lengua española no encuentra la suficiente expresividad o las suficientes palabras para expresar sus sentimientos, que en ninguna de sus poesías usó puramente español, sino los mezcló. Tal vez se tiene que tener en cuenta los hermanos que tienen la desgracia de no saber bien el español, pero de todos modos, vamos a aceptar la lengua española como toda su belleza, ¿por qué no se usa o el español o el inglés?
¿Te duele? Bueno. Sin lugar a dudas, el lenguaje, la lengua de nuestros padres, de nuestros abuelos, la lengua de nosotros, es una lengua mucho más expresiva, mucho más bella, mucho más emocional, mucho más viva que cualquier otra lengua que existe en todo el universo, en mi opinión. Sin embargo, la realidad es de que muchos de nuestros carnales no hablan el español, no hablan la lengua. Y sin embargo, tenemos que tomar en cuenta de que tenemos que juntar a la raza, tenemos que unificar a nuestros carnales, tenemos que hablar con aquellos que no entienden la lengua porque se las han cortado. Una vez que la raza empiece y comience a darse cuenta de lo que somos, no habrá necesidad tal vez de hablar el idioma anglosajón, el cual yo aborrezco naturalmente, pero sin embargo tengo que usar porque mucha raza no habla español.
Además, hay otro punto. Que el español, así como el inglés, fue impuesto sobre nuestras razas antiguas. Y es el gachupa. Si nos llamamos José y Juanes y Manueles, no es porque siempre fuimos Juanes y Manueles.
En un tiempo fuimos Tizocs. En un tiempo fuimos con otros nombres. Queríamos organizar en Fresno, pero no se pudo. Un bautismo, tal vez será posible más tarde en el año. Un bautismo de todos los chicanos y chicanas que querían cambiar su nombre de nombre español a nombre indio. Así es que, dado eso de que el español es bello, pero hay que recordar que también es muy bello el yaqui y el náhuatl y el maya y muchísimas otras idiomas que están relacionadas con nuestra sangre colorada y la piel oscura.
Yeah, go ahead. Y es precisamente por las razones que ustedes dan que quiero dar mi pregunta en inglés.
Ok.
Porque quiero que los que no comprenden español me comprendan. Would you please tell us how do we speak to people of our own ethnic group who are the people who refer to themselves as Spanish American or Mexican American of Mexican descent or completely try to deny any of their Mexican or the Indian heritage? How do I myself, for example, speak to people that I have encountered in this room as I have gone around with a petition and had them put me down and put all of us down for what is going on here? How do you speak to them? I'm not talking about the gabacho, I'm not talking about the white man, I'm talking about our own people who have sold us out.
One of the things that we'll all find out when we get involved in organization is that we don't always move all of the people together. The people and all of us have gone through the brainwashing machine. And we have to treat it like an infection. We have to treat it like a sickness. And those of us who think we know that we are doctors, we have to cure. We have to start to teach. We have to start to show points. We need that patience. We need revolutionary patience. But let me explain one thing. 1% of any given population can move the whole group. Now, when the action comes, as it did say in Denver, at West Denver, when the young people moved out and we went to support them, and the police came down on us, they polarized the community and drew everybody with them. The vendidos, the cagaos, everybody came because it was an issue of the community versus the establishment, and the demands were right and the problem was there. And what happened was that the people went to the police department en masse. They showed up the next day en masse. And what happened is that in one action, all the racism of Anglo teachers, of gringo editorials, of gringo writers and press, all the teeth came out. And we didn't have to preach no more about racism. They saw it. And some of the sisters in the Catholic schools were mad at the kids who didn't even walk out, but they were mad. And the young people know why. And the young people start thinking. And from there it went on to another school, another school, another school. And the action sometimes does the organizing and the teaching. But we like to think that we send fishermen out. That's why we had a conference, to have 1,500 young people say, I can understand the system. I can understand who I am. I can understand exploitation. I can understand freedom and liberation. And then go out and teach it. It's a hard thing. It takes time. But while we're planning all these things to get along, to bring everybody together, one action can bring us all together. One action can bring the community together. And that's why I say that the time will come when one action, our security will keep the police out of our barrios. You know, our security will keep, protect their own people. And the community in itself will start to offer leadership. And even some of the weakest people have come along. When you had the East LA boycott, walkout, didn't it take everybody with it? Took the politicians, the OEO leadership, everybody had to go. Everybody went with the youngsters and the parents. When the current starts, we're all gonna go. And I'm just getting me a boat ready so I can go along with it.
Okay.
Hey, Juan.
Yeah.
Could I just say one thing? I wanted to say one thing that I feel is very important, is that about the lives that we live in this movement, and that is that throughout our lives, every action that we commit every day is it's confronted by an enemy every second, and we must be aware of this enemy, and this enemy is materialism. It's totally an enemy that will destroy us and can destroy us. It's the only one that has the potential to destroy us. It's the only one, the one that causes all the vendidos and all of the rest of the shit. So what we have to do is to think collectively. When we do something, even if nobody sees us, whatever we do, if we see a gabacho that we don't like in the street and we spit him, even if he doesn't see us, that is doing something collectively for our people. And this is very important that we think collectively, that we think not as individuals. The gabacho is trying to divide us by the car you own, where you live, by the books you buy, by the courses you take in this university, by the clothes that you wear. Everything has to do with individualism. Now, this is an enemy that confronts us even right now. Every second, it thinks in terms of individuals. And we are not individuals. We are la raza. Thank you.
Bueno, antes de partir, un aplauso chicano. De pie.
¡Viva la raza!
¡Viva!
¡Viva la raza!
¡Viva!
¡Viva la raza!
¡Viva!